Hello and welcome to the In the Money. I'm getting like this huge playback through my speakers, Craig. What am I doing wrong? I'll start that again. Oh, now there we go. Hello and welcome to the In the Money Players Podcast contest happy hour. We've been doing this late week. This is our fourth show and really one of the high points of my week professionally anyway. Great to get a chance to be here with you playing along for this six race pick and pray contest. It starts in, it's Gulfstream, so a little tricky, but probably about 13, 14 minutes. Still time to get involved if you go over to horseplayers.com and you look for our virtual happy hour event. It costs $20. The rake going to charity, going to the Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation and the Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance. And you get a chance to win your seat into tomorrow's qualifier for the Breeders' Cup Betting Challenge, the best horse racing contest out there as far as I am concerned. And I hope that we've had stories already of success, people participating in this on a Friday, helping charity and punching their ticket to the big dance, $10,000 value on that one. We encourage you to do the same. And when I say we, I mean not only me, but my usual co-hosts on these shows. We've been here for all three of them, and we will start with the man. Is that my right or my left? I don't know with this configuration. The usual co-host of these shows in general. He is the People's Champion. Not sure what's going on with his hair, not living up to his big hair name, but he is the People's Champion from the planet Texas. Jonathan Kinchin, JK, what's happening?
PTF, I had to rock this fresh Breeders' Cup hat that I got for the Breeders' Cup this year.
Sweet.
You didn't even
that's
get to see the ball at the top, huh? it's like a de facto fro at the top.
There you go. The little pom-pom in place of the fro today. And also we have with us from an undisclosed location in Massachusetts, guy who's been absolutely killing it with his recent eponymous podcast. He is TV's Matt Bernier. MB, what's going on?
How are we doing, gentlemen? Let's call this, is the place where the witches lie. That's where I'm from. That's where I'm living. If you can't put that together, I can't help you. But yeah, no, all's well, man. All's well. A little bit of a windy day here today, but the weather started to turn and just got snapped at the wire at Tampa, which is not a great feeling. But, you know, it happens. We got a long way to go. And yeah, all's well. Happy to be here.
Good. Good stuff. And yes, stay away from the moldy bread. That's my advice to you, Matt. And you guys both playing in this contest. JK, what you got?
Speaking of playing in it, PTF, I'm going to tweet you guys. I'm tagging you guys right now in a tweet. So grab your phone and retweet. I'm telling people I got 10 minutes to get involved. So I didn't want to waste that opportunity or that timing. So you got a couple minutes if you haven't got involved yet.
I hit it. I hit the retweet. That should be good. Hopefully, there've been a couple of weird contests the last couple of weeks. We had 2 weeks ago, we had the object lesson in the problem of the live format in a short contest where you basically had to have the long shot in the last. Last week, it was fairer, I suppose, but also incredibly boring when we had the bombs come in the second leg and most people were virtually drawing dead from there in the pick and pray. So we're hoping to get something a little more even-handed throughout. I'll start with the question I've asked you guys at the beginning of all of these shows. You involved, and are you single or double-handed, Matt Bernier?
Single as far as our contest is concerned, but I got in through some feeder action earlier today into the actual BCBC contest today and the 10K over on Horse Tourneys. So I've got a little bit of extra action going on here. In fact, we've got two races already down. So that's my sort of exposure for this afternoon, one in all three.
Multitasking, multi-tabling, as we call it, something that it's funny, man. When I started writing the winning contest player, whatever that was now, 6-7 years ago, geez, I've lost track. But that idea was like somewhat novel, playing in multiple contests at once. And I feel like these days, almost all serious contest players who are playing online always have their fingers in many pies, as it were. JK, how about you? What are you doing today? And what's your feeling generally on playing in more than one contest at once?
I'm doing one today. I got a kind of a later start to handicapping, so I didn't want to be too aggressive here. Usually when I play, if I'm going to play in a contest, a $2 win place contest online, I'm not playing in one, I'm playing in like six. If I feel like I like what I'm doing and I'm playing for a reason, then I'm going to play in feeders to this, feeders to that, some head-to-heads with the same races. I'm going to play in some cash games, same races. I'm going to try to kind of maximize that day, that opinion, those thoughts. And so I usually will play in a handful. Now, one thing, if you're new to this, be careful. Do not play in a live and a pick and pray at the same time. Because if you're doing good, someone can, and I've done this before, and somebody, look, you shouldn't do it. You can go and see what someone else played and know where they might go in your other contest. So always stick to one or the other when you're playing in these contests.
That's smart. Just to clarify, JK is saying if you're in that live contest where folks can maneuver around, if you've also put in picks that would be published up on the horseplayers.com site, then they can know what your best opinion is, what your live long shot is, and potentially attempt to hoist you on your own petard, as it were. Is that something you pay attention to, Matt?
Well, so just kind of like piggybacking on that, and this hasn't been the instance recently anyway, but back when I was working with the racing form, there was a BCBC live contest that I was playing in on a Saturday when Kentucky Downs was racing. And the last race was the Kentucky Downs Turf Cup or Turf Classic, whichever one, whatever it's called, the long distance turf race. We had done a video preview of that race earlier in the week, and I liked Manitoulin. And now I don't know if people like genuinely hated the horse, but not one other person in the contest picked the horse. I can only assume it's because people knew where I was going to go with it.
That's very funny. There are some great stories like that with people who give out picks publicly. Mark McGuire, not the home run king, but the accomplished contest player, has a story about he was in, I think it was a head-to-head against Ellis Starr, who we all know from online and from Keeneland. And I wish I could, it'd be a much better story if I could remember the specific angle, but it was some trainer play, and it came down to the last race, and there was a horse with this angle that Ellis had been touting, and Mark had read the column, and sure enough, you know, he was up a little bit going into the contest, Mark was, and sure enough, by the time the gates popped for that last race, Ellis was drawing cold dead because Mark had nicked his angle, blocked the heck out of him. And I have to say, in contest, for me, that was always one of the most satisfying feelings, when you're on the right end of a block and you've won in the last leg as the gates pop and you see the picks, and one of the most frustrating when it goes against you. Is it something you think about at the end of contest, Jonathan, when you're playing in the live format? Are you consciously trying to block, or are you always playing who you like?
Oh, no, you can't just play what you like in a live contest late. You got to play the math. You got to see where you are, who can get you there. You have to look at what the people in – let me back up. Say you're in fifth place and you got to win it. You got to win the whole thing to get something. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look to see how far behind fourth, third, second are. What kind of horses have they been playing all day? Will a short price get them there? Will my horse get them there? Will they be on my horse? You got to play that in-game theory. So you have to do that. The same can be said if you're on the lead. You have to protect yourself. Okay, what can catch me? Second place is $5 behind. He can't play the 3-5 shot. I'm clear there. Now you can move on to the next horse. And then you can try to identify. It is a complete and important part of the end of a contest, is that in-game of identifying where other people are going to go.
So real quick, I don't mean to cut you off. I'm curious. I want to know, Jonathan, what you would have done in this situation. So I was in the lead going into that race, and it was pretty strung out at the top. There were only a handful of folks. Like, if a 20-1 shot came in, so be it. But the idea was, would I have been better off playing to block or playing the horse that I actually liked to win the race, who was 10-1, which essentially would have blocked out a horse that somebody in third or fourth could have used to sort of leapfrog me? You know, I kind of got in my own head, and I was like, and by the way, the horse that I was afraid of was Arklo. He ended up winning, and that was enough for that guy to pass me to win, and I finished second. So I always go back to that, and I don't know if I played it the way I should have, where it was, again, it's not like I liked to chalk. I liked the horse that was going to, in theory, eliminate someone else from behind me. But I always go back to that and think, like, should I have done something differently?
When in doubt, play what you like. So in that situation, if you felt like you liked the horse, you did a preview on the horse for real work, you like the horse, you play the horse. Because if that horse wins, it's going to be significantly more stressful and upsetting to you than if you got beat by the horse you like. Now, when Arklow beat you and you were scared of Arklow, you didn't do a piece on Arklow. He beat you. Fair enough. You got to play what you like in those situations. I think you made the right decision.
And that's why I didn't feel bad.
I'll say also getting beat by Arklow makes you fit right in with the two knuckleheads on the side of you because that's happened to us many times. Is the picture up there, JK?
He's hanging up on the wall over there. I'm not going to get up to get him, but he's right over there. I still see him.
Story later. We're about to go to post here for this fifth race at Gulfstream, the first one in our pick and pray contest. Let's give the viewers out there playing along some thoughts. JK, we'll start with you.
Yeah, Pete, you usually give me a much bigger lead up when we're doing this on the show.
Even though it's Gulfstream and 0 minutes might still mean four, I get nervous that I had a host fail and didn't leave us enough time. I want to make sure people can bet these races, JK, because the idea is you can not only donate by participating in the horseplayers.com contest, but hopefully you're going to hit some of these horses that we give you and then want to donate to charity. And you can do that at the TAA site, or you can go to our link, trf.org/ Did I say it wrong? TRFinc.org/players, where you can donate not only to the TRF, but we also have a link there now at your excellent suggestion, JK, to donate to the New York Racetrack Chaplaincy, who've been doing amazing work, always do amazing work, and particularly amazing work here in New York right now. So that's why I want to give you plenty of time to give winners. Was that enough of a run-up? Are you ready to talk?
Yeah, that was too much. Now I landed on the 8 polished copper. I'm a big fan of the owner when you see him in the running lines, Bob Bone. I think I've sat with Bob before as a horse player, as a handicapper. He is extremely sharp, and I think that kind of carries over to his claiming. I feel the same way about Marshall Graham and 10 Strike Racing. When they claim, I'm paying attention because there's good handicappers there. Same with Rich Averill, Averill Racing. And so when I saw that Bob dropped in this, claimed this horse for 25, ran him for 30, and he ran well. Excuse me, her. She ran well in that spot. She was bet that day, closing into a slow pace. I expect her to run better in here. And so I landed on the 8 polished Cooper. She's good. Copper. She's a good price at 10-1.
Matt, what do you think?
No, look, I'm maybe we have too much weight on her, but I like her in here. I went with polished copper as well. I'm a little bit surprised about the price. I figured she would take a little bit of money in here. Other reasons that Jonathan laid out, not only did she run well, but the form of the race has come back to look relatively solid. The winner that they fancified, who really kind of, I don't want to say blitzed her, but you know, made this big move on the far outside. She came back and won next out with a 65 buyer. So if you're trying to find some sort of a common ground there, I thought this was a really solid effort from her. And, if it wasn't her for me, it was going to be one of the speed horses. It was going to be a horse like Choo Choo Debo, or who's the other one here? Is it Pletcher's horse? Oh, no, I'm sorry. Clement's horse, Lake Parima. And I just, they ran fine, but there was about 6 horses that you could have thrown a blanket over at the wire. And I was more intrigued with polished copper's effort than I was the 2 speed. So I went with her. And again, the price is right.
JK, it's funny. You just texted me to ask you this question, and it was next on my list anyway. Are we fading this chalk completely? What do you think about number 2?
No, not completely. The horse debuted maiden special weight. Oh, I just fought off a sneeze. I did it, I think. I'm successful. It started to come back after I talked about it. He started in maiden special weight. It's Pletcher. It's Starlight. The horse dropped in for 50, ran well that day in a blanket finish. And now what you see is the horse is now dropping again down to 25. The problem I have is that the figure isn't that fast compared to the other horses. And so in that situation, I don't want a short price horse who is kind of in the same area from a figure standpoint and who has Todd Pletcher, a good name, and Starlight Racing and dropping. If that one wins, we'll call it the protection of the chalk, which is something we've talked about in contests before, is that in Matt's situation that he was referring to, it didn't really work out for him. But usually in these types of situations, you can let this horse win at 3-2. And if he wins, no one's out of reach for you to catch. Or if she wins, they're not out of reach. So I'm not going to fade from a betting standpoint, but from a contest standpoint, I'll let her beat me.
You mentioned the betting standpoint. If you were betting cash money in this race, what would your position look like?
No, I think you could use, obviously you would want to use her. You'd want to use the 8 as well, a polished copper. And then the Clement horse I thought was interesting. Interesting, wasn't really behaving well last time loading in the gate. So take a look at that now if you're looking at the screen and watch how the nine loads this time. She didn't do a good job of it last time. So those are the main contenders in here that I would use from a cash standpoint.
We're doing something cool and different this time. We're going to have video of these races playing. We on our playback, I don't think, are going to be hearing the call. I think listeners might be able to hear the call, but this should be fun. And we'll still talk over it a little bit if we have something to say. We also might let it speak for itself a bit.
If you're watching the Facebook feed, in the comments, if you don't mind, if it's not coming over clear to you, if it's really choppy, we might not be aware that you're getting it choppy. So just let us know, and maybe in the next races we'll skip that part of it. It's not going to work out well.
You go ahead, Matt. Just from if somebody's trying to gamble on this race, kind of piggybacking on Jonathan's piece there, like Parima, yeah, she was a bit of a bad actor, but if you're going to use her, I think you have to use the five also, who, look, she's had some issues staying out the distance and seeing it out, but if you're playing Exactus, Tri, Super, whatever it may be, I think she's at least one that you have to at least consider underneath because she's going to be forwardly placed.
A little bit of money late for your guys' eight into the teeth of the favorite, who's also shortening. I've got to think that's a good little bit of a sign of liveness.
Yeah, I can also tell you who it probably is that made the wager.
Yeah, exactly. But
not a bad thing.
See that fade. All right, getting ready to pop here, it looks like. I'm watching my playback is the Facebook Live feed, and it's looking great. So
I was going to say, I've got my own feed up, too, and they're both on par. So they're literally in lockstep.
All right, that's good. Let's see what's going on. Are you guys happy with where you are here? Everybody on the eight?
Yeah, I mean, she got over there saving ground. I got no problem with that.
Yeah, of course. That's a good position. I mean, look, this is a great example of, without looking at fractions, they're probably not going that fast because they're all in the picture. Mm-hmm. So if you, for whatever reason, if you don't see the fractions, you're trying to understand where you are in a race, a picture when there's 10 horses in the pan at one time, they're probably not going too fast.
This is also this five on the front end. She did something very similar last time, too. You can see, I'm not saying she's hard to handle, but she's certainly not the most relaxed horse you've ever seen on the front end. She's going a little bit, and I think that's probably part of the issue that she has when it comes to, you know, seeing out that final 16th of a mile. I think that's part of the reason she usually hits the wall, or she has anyway.
What do you think about where this deuce is right now, JK? Do you like it?
No excuse. She doesn't win. She, you know. She's got no excuse from down in there. She saved every step of ground. She's getting the five should come off the rail here. They usually do when they start to get a little bit tired. Louis hadn't had to stop riding yet. She didn't come off the rail, but yeah, he's got no excuse.
Yeah, I was wondering if it could get a lacking room, but it looks like this hole is going to open up. We will see momentarily.
Get through there.
Get through. Go.
Come here.
Go. You got it. Finish.
The tip.
You got it. Get there. There we go.
All right, I like it.
That's a donation.
The big smooch from Jonathan.
That's a donation to the TRF and TAA. So go ahead and load up the URL for those two places. If you cashed on that, you gotta give a little bit.
The five also. She almost made me look like an idiot because she nearly did what I thought she was not capable of doing.
Wow, that's a good way to start. That's gonna put you guys in very nice shape in such a short contest. The rest of the way, JK, were you speculative at mid and longer, or did you, at this point, now that you've hit a nice price early, I would imagine you'd be pretty pleased even just to have some logical shorties. And of course, I have the right shirt on for it too here today. The old chalk sucking weasel. What describe for me the rest of your run?
Well, first of all, the pill pull from the eight that Gulfstream really messed me up. I had all eights and nines in my run, and I had to pick the five in the last because I didn't get lucky. The eight and the nine had no shot. So I actually have my let's see here. I'm 3-1 in the next. I'm 9-2 in the race after that. I am 5-2. I am 8-1, and I am 7-2. But look, I mean, if I hit two more horses after hitting this one, you probably hit the top 10%, most likely, in a situation like this where you start off with an 8-1. You get a couple more, pick up some more pieces along the way, you should be okay.
We got 6 minutes at Gulfs at Tampa, till Tampa. That's probably a legit 6 minutes. So we'll reflect on the leaderboard here in a minute, and then Oh, I just completely lost my train of thought. I hate it when that happens. But we'll take a look at the leaderboard, and we also want to take a look at how many people played and what who gets prizes in this thing. Did either of you guys have the contest page up?
Stand by. Let's see. Top 16 get into tomorrow afternoon's contest. Top three non-winners will get the $20 back. So all told, there were 163 entries. So pretty good turnout. And hopefully some folks can parlay this into a $10,000 BCBC speed.
Let's see.
Yeah, I mean, top 16, that's not bad at all. I can pop this up here in another screen so I can help lead some of that conversation. And we'll definitely run down some of the names who, along with you two, had that nice winner. Once we get that information, should be momentarily. Maybe in the meantime, we should just go ahead and look to this Tampa Bay race, and then we can loop. We'll go ahead and loop back to this. We'll start with you, Matt. What did you come up with in Tampa race number 7 with 5 minutes to post?
Nothing interesting, honestly. I kind of felt like these last two at Tampa were more or less formful. I had a hard time getting super creative. And for me, the 7/8 races at Tampa, it can be a little bit, you know, you can make up a little bit more ground than just saying it's straight away. You know, you make the front, you're going to win the race. I still would rather be on the front than trying to rally from off of it. So I ended up with the 9, Sacco and Vanzetti. Broke the maiden most recently by, you know, 3 or 4 lengths. Steps up in class. But, you know, I said it earlier with one of the races that I was tweeting about. I'm never opposed to using maiden winners last out against winners for the first time. I know a lot of people look at it and say it's, you know, it's arguably the largest jump in class you're ever going to see. But I especially don't care about that when we're talking about non-winners of 2 lifetime and a number of horses that have not totally won races in how long. So totally I want to have a horse that has some form, has some speed, can go on with it. Again, it's not a brilliant opinion, but I went with the 9.
That's my key thing when you're looking at the idea of first against winners. Sometimes I do think it's almost like underrated as how difficult of a class raise it can be. But the exception is in these restricted races when you'd much rather have the horse that's in form. And if they've all only run once, give me that horse right back against horses that may be a little camera shy. JK, what do you think about that angle? First of all, is that something you look at as a potential class raise the first time against winners? And what did you end up doing here in Tampa's 7th?
We're all not good at things, and that's probably one thing that I need to be more aware of and more cautious of is taking that into consideration. Because often I just – because I'm such a person who looks at speed figures and trips and the final figure and the pace figure, that logic to me suggests that horse won that race because he or she was facing horses that weren't as good as the horses – that he or she's going to face today. And although that is most likely the case, sometimes the pace figures in the final times suggest the performance was still pretty good. But there's that one hidden part of when you're facing lesser, you're able to do what you want to do in order to earn those better figures and numbers throughout the race. And that's I miss that sometimes. So if that's the answer to that question, I think.
Yeah, it totally is. Now give us your thoughts on this Tampa race, and then we should still have time to run down some of these folks who hit this first winner other than you two.
I was deciding between two. I was deciding between the horse that Matt picked, the 9, which is definitely something I would make you pronounce. That's not a racist thing. but here's what I'll say is that looking at Timeform US, it's something that I learned from the Matisse brothers. They call it a down line. And looking at Timeform US's pace figures, for instance, the 9's last race, 102, 95, 87, 83, meaning that it was declining. The race before that, 113, 89, 67, 54. I don't like downline horses going 7 furlongs because I just think that they're getting tired late. I landed on the 8 Indian Buzz. I thought the last race was pretty good, ran into a pretty good horse that was 9-5 that won that day. I wouldn't be shocked if either one of them win, but I do think one of the two will win, and I went with the 8.
Which was the name you were having trouble with here? I can't even tell scrolling through.
Sacco and Vanzetti.
Oh, that sounds like it might be your kinfolk.
There's not enough time to get into who Sacco and Vanzetti are, but there is a story there. It is a bizarre horse name, but maybe we'll touch on that in a minute. But all right, so there are your thoughts on this race. We are what, 1 minute away? So I'll run this down real quick. It ain't over yet, folks. 31 players had that winner. Just scrolling through. The folks who had it, several folks had it on more than one entry, always impressive. Among them, Truls Engebretsen had it on two different entries. And also Christopher Olsen, who I met out at the NHC, did some radio with me and Steve Bick a couple of years ago, had it on all three entries. So you got to love that leverage, having it on all three. You know, lots of names that I recognize, including Pete Cook up there, our buddy from Lexington, the chef. Spencer Vandendoel came to our tailgate. Sam Stinson, loyal supporter of all of our efforts. Good to see him there. Gary Fenton of Little Red Feather. Chris Couples, we met at this year's NHC. GT Nixon, experienced contest player, whose name I know. Michael Webb, we know from Twitter, obviously. You two knuckleheads. Also in there, the man in black, JK. The man in black.
The man in black. You know, he's not a tech guy. I'm going to text him to see if he's watching right now. Let's see if the man in black is watching.
But it's an impressive array. You got to be happy with where you are. But, yeah, this is the kind of thing where I was thinking maybe a few fewer people would have had it. But I guess one thing about that horse, that's a sweet spot for contest play in that odds range. And, obviously, sharp cappers were all over.
And one other thing, PTF, there's a couple of people – that I believe, I'm not going to get them all, but just give me a Chris Couples, the man in black, James Henry, I think maybe GT Nixon. They had the 8 on one entry and the 5 on the other. So I'm assuming that they hit a nice little exacta there.
Oh, very smart. I didn't think about that. Yeah, hopefully some cash money was made, and hopefully their entries are going to bring them, their contention will run deep in this contest as they try to make their way via horseplayers.com into this year's Breeders' Cup Betting Challenge. Of course, folks can, if you don't win today, you can always go to Horseplayers and buy in directly in that contest tomorrow. What is it, $129 entry, Jonathan?
$179. Yeah. I will say this, and we'll talk about it more. If you qualify, it is in your best interest to buy another entry and have two. Because yes, you're increasing your opportunity to get the actual qualification out of the great effort you had today. So just think twice about that.
Yeah, two entries effectively for $200.
Yeah,
that's pretty sweet. Absolutely. And your advice, JK, about two entries is pretty well known. Matt, what's your approach typically when playing two entries in a live format mythical contest?
I know it's probably, you know, you could go through and poke holes in this idea. I tend to find two horses that I like early on and just kind of go back and forth. And ultimately, whichever ticket has more money on it, I'll play the shorter price, because just statistically, the shorter prices win more often than the longer ones do. And look, I've had instances where I'll run two in the top 15 and I don't get anything out of it. Whereas had I consolidated, I'd be okay. But I mean, that's, you know, again, I'm sure there are people that would look at that and say that's the wrong way to play it. That's also not to say I won't play the same horse on both tickets if I really like a 5, 6, 7 to 1 shot, especially, like you say, kind of in that sweet spot. But that's typically how I go about it.
They have popped at Tampa. Remind us again, give us your number of who you played in here, JK first, then Matt.
8.
But meanwhile, 9.
We've got the 8 and the 9 for the team assembled here, and we'll let this race play out. Matt, feel free if you want to talk us through it a little bit, but again, they can hear the call under, so we can let the race speak for itself too.
Yeah, I mean, look, a little interesting that Big Yes, the one horse, just broke like a shot and went right to the top. I thought my horse was going to be right up there, the 9, and 22-4, yeah, it's fast, but a length and a half farther back. I don't know. I think the dynamic of the race changed a little bit when that amount of horses, that number of horses were out there cooking on the front end. Who do you have, Jonathan? 8?
No, I'm rooting for you. I'm almost starting to root for you.
Oh, you just said you did.
Yeah, because I'm not the – the 9 is not traveling. The 8 is not really going anywhere. So I'm suddenly – I'm on your horse now.
Now –
It's Big Yes along the rail, and Sacco and Vincetti on the outside. Brim's at the leader second. 2.5 lengths farther back, Austin Romeo is there. Third, KC Two-Step is there toward the rail fourth.
And they look, he's going to go by the one right now. It doesn't matter. I think the 10's got a chance. But so this is, I sound like a broken record when I talk about this. Horses that will not pass a parked car. It's a thing. And it doesn't matter how fast they are. If they don't make the front, they're not going to go. And with these lower level races, the logic for me was I thought the 9 was going to make the top. He didn't. The 1 did. And the 1 just won at 25-1. So something else to keep in mind. Some of these lower level horses, they're not willing to pass one another. And that's why speed in general is imperative. But at a level like this, if you can make the top and look good on the rider or the 1 to quarter horse this one out of there. But it's always something to keep in mind.
An enterprising ride, and it was rewarded. And what a shakeup. Here I was thinking you guys were in good position. You're not in bad position, but we're going to have to see how many folks use this one. I guess in a pick and pray situation, this horse might not be terribly well represented. We'll have to see. We could scroll through. It's one of the cool features of horseplayers.com that you can scroll through and see who had what. I would imagine you two are crossing fingers that that a minimum of people had this one, and that you'll still be sitting pretty when we see a leaderboard update in a few minutes. But
well, before we get
to the leaderboard update, you had something, JK?
Well, just real quick, yeah. I mean, the next thing coming up is more important than what I'm about to say. But the good thing about playing these contests is you could actually just kind of scroll through real quick and look for that red saddle cloth number. Brian Ivory had the one, and that's it on the first page. So another advantage of the pick and pray is that people that might have felt like they were in trouble and started reaching for bombs, they're not able to switch it at this point.
No question, with a decent price winning the first, more people would have switched on to that one had there been an opportunity to do so. But at this point, I want to bring in our first guest today. She's been on these shows before, and she's got an exciting new podcast of her own to talk about. We welcome in our colleague, Naomi Tukker. Naomi, how are you today?
Hey, guys. I'm good. Guess where I'm sitting right now.
I'm trying to see. Is that, are you actually at Laurel Park?
I am, and I got locked out of my own office because I haven't been in there in 3 weeks. So I thought I'm going to pat myself in the grandstand. So I'll do a quick sweep around. Look at that, guys.
Unbelievable.
That's quite the office.
It's a little bit unfair. It's a little bit unfair for the rest of us that aren't able to go to a racetrack. You're flaunting that a little bit.
only a tiny bit. I'm currently working at the stable gate, so it's only a small sort of route to get here, and I thought, let's go back to my old office. Also, I needed Wi-Fi, so I wanted to go somewhere where they had that, and where else to sit than in my favorite place.
Fantastic. Now, I assume since you were obviously working today that you did not have an opportunity to get involved and play in this contest, or were you able to throw a quick entry in?
Did actually. Unfortunately, I'm 0-2 right now, so let's just pretend I wasn't playing, okay?
You still have a chance to run down Jonathan and improve your mark against him to 2-3-0. I can't remember exactly what it is, but I did note that you've got him on the form book, so that's certainly a very good start. So I wanted to have you on here, obviously, to talk about your journey in the contest world, to see how you're doing in general, but I also want to give you a chance to talk about this new show. You've been helping us out and doing great work on the network for months now, but this is the first time you've released your own show. Tell us what it's called, what your vision for it is.
Indeed. Well, it's super exciting because it was an idea that we sort of started talking about last year when I was still working at Belmont with the Naira team, which hope to join them soon again. But it's a new show called Talk Racing to Me with Naomi. Now, when I was pitching this name to a few of my male colleagues, there were a few giggles there. So I thought, yes, that is the good one. That's a name I want. I want to go with the name that makes people kind of go, okay. So it's a show that would basically be based around stories, because I personally very much love stories from any types of sport. I'm also a big Formula One fan, love listening to their sort of background stories. And then doing that in racing, I thought, how good would it be if I can just get different guests on board every week and basically talk about things that have occupied them or things that they have experienced. Also talking about more current events. So this week's first episode, I included Sebastian Hutch, who is the English general manager of Bloodsuck and Marketing, talking about the English sale that they just had, the Australian Easter Yearling Sale, which is their flagship sale, their elite yearling sale. And of course, due to the outbreak of COVID-19, they had to completely throw the handbook out of the window and basically go with a completely different format. And they did it incredibly well. It was a really strong result that they posted. A lot of really good feedback, of course, not without a hurdle. So it was really great to get the chat with Sebastian about that. And spoke to Jockey Forest Boyce about her rehoming H Fast Catch, which is a three-time Maryland Million Classic winner. So all these really different stories, but especially now with everyone sort of being stuck at home, it'd be great to listen to a lot of different perspectives, so to speak.
Especially on the sales front, I think that's really interesting. I'm sure there's all kinds of high-level conversations going on about what's going to happen with the traditionally important sales in the United States and the possibility of doing virtual sales. I'm sure there'll be a lot of people wanting to tune in and get some of that vicarious experience. So very good on you for putting that together. Have you been playing the horse as much, Naomi, as you've been, you know, obviously you've been working, but when you haven't been at work, have you had an opportunity to do much in the way of betting?
Actually, this sort of ties in with an article I read quite recently in the TDN about being that sort of betting player friend to all your non-horse racing friends. Yep. A friend of mine, I've completely converted him now. He'll go in and go, who do you like in this race? He doesn't even give me 2 seconds. Right? I'm like, hold on, I'm going to grab the PPs and let me look at this, okay? So I'm sitting there handicapping, I like him. He's already placed his bet. He's like, this horse is 6-1. This is fine. And he just goes... And he's actually won a couple of times. I'm having a lot of fun. And yes, I'm handicapping still, because obviously that's, you know, what I love to do. And so excited for tomorrow's Oakland card, especially the Apple Blossom. Oh my God, still trying to solve that puzzle. That is so great. I can't wait to see how that will unfold.
We'll talk about that. If that, the voice you hear in the background potentially there is Perrin. She is over on the day bed in the office here watching. I'm not sure what, probably some Star Wars related show. But I do want to actually come back to the Apple Blossom. But Naomi, you gave me two good points to throw it back to JK. One, the idea of new podcast on the network, something that JK has something to say about. And the other is I do feel like now more than ever, it's like Derby Day every day almost, in that we have, if you're a racing person, we have friends coming out of the woodwork asking us questions about horse racing. And I think, JK, for you, you can talk about your first show that you did this week, but also your show next week and how that might be something that we want to turn our new friends who are looking at racing for the first time onto. Tell us what you've been up to.
Yeah, it's a great point, Pete. I mean, this is a unique opportunity, obviously. We try not to use the word silver lining. It's kind of a weird word to say when the economy is struggling and people are losing their lives. But I think that it's an opportunity for us to promote our sport and to introduce it to our friends that don't have any other sports to watch. And, you know, one piece of advice that I would give is that, you know, they're asking how to build a house. You got to show them how to use a hammer first. So don't try to give them too much. Let them have fun. Yeah, I know that show bets are controversial and it's not the toughest thing or the most machismo laced wager that we offer, but just get your friends to have some fun. Let them see the ball go through the hoop. And so, like you mentioned, Pete, yes, we've been talking about a new podcast idea and us being locked in the house. What better time to take some time to set all that up. And I've had this vision of a long form one-on-one podcast similar to what you see with Joe Rogan, who has the most popular podcast in the world, and another one I'm a big fan of, Theo Vaughn. He's got a little bit more silliness to his, but just having long conversations with people and just letting the conversation go where it is. And if you're interviewing a trainer, not asking them the best horse they ever trained, but asking them who their favorite football team is and letting that conversation happen, just kind of letting people in to these racing celebrities' world. And I was lucky enough to have Gary Stevens on this week, and one of my favorite stories you told was about the worst kickback he'd ever experienced, and it didn't hit him in the face, and it wasn't dirt. So you could check out that story. We also talked about snipers and him tackling a patron at Santa Anita at one point. So a lot of fun stories, and Next week, my goal is to have my friend that I've mentioned on the show. I believe he's probably playing in the contest, Hunter Archibald.
He won a seed to the qualifier last week.
He did. Hunter and I met in college playing video game contests together, and he was the guy that would text me on Breeders' Cup Day and Kentucky Derby Day, and he would ask me who I like, and he would make his wagers however he could do it. Well, now he's a full-fledged horse player. He's sending me pick three tickets. He's wheeling things. He's A, B horses. He's dutching. He's doing all kinds of stuff. And so my plan next week is to have an episode where for 2 hours he's asking me questions as a new horse player. And I'm hoping that it will be a reverse engineered thing that new players could listen to get some insight.
Matt, before we get to the handicapping of this race, I want to bring you back in because I've really been enjoying your content on your show, not just staying on top of what's going on, but also some of the stuff that I describe as evergreen content. I particularly enjoyed your episode going back and looking at the best Kentucky Derby fields of the last 20 years, but I still don't know how you didn't give that 07 field the top mark. What kind of reactions have you been getting from the audience?
Yeah, I think it's, for the most part, it's been positive. And I feel like in an instance like this, the main reason I wanted to go down that road, and it won't just be the Derby, I'm sure I'll look at other fields and other races going forward. But in a time like this, where there are only so many stakes races to go over and talk about and so many trips, I mean, unless you're just going over the entire card for Tampa, for Gulfstream, for Oaklawn, you got to have a little bit of something else going on. So I figured this was a good time to sort of open up the idea of some back and forth, just spitball as if you're at the bar, you're at a restaurant, and you're just saying, you know, I think you're crazy. I think you're smart. I think this, that, or the other thing. And I've always just maintained, just give me a reason why. I don't want to just hear, oh, it's this and that just because. That doesn't do me any good. So that's been one of my favorite things, is trying to keep some sort of line of communication open with anybody that watches or listens, just because it doesn't, I don't want to just talk into space. I want to have other people be able to go back and forth and either agree or disagree, for better or for worse. And I there are some people that have really, really wonderful comments and other people that are just the definition of a troll, but I'm okay with that. I mean, that's part of what I think makes it as fun as it is. So I did that a couple weeks ago, and I'm sure I'll start rolling out some other ones here in the near future.
I did tell a guy to kick rocks on Twitter today. I figured that was a good, and I put a little wink emoji, so I felt like I could get away. And he was English, so I felt like I didn't feel like I had to obey my normal block and move.
That's one of my favorite.
Yeah,
I told my girlfriend to kick rocks the other day, and it didn't go over as well as I thought it would.
All right, we've got 0 minutes to post at Gulfstream, which means we have plenty of time for all three of you to give your thoughts on the race. Naomi, we're going to start with you. Who did you play in the contest in this spot and why?
I am actually going with a bit of an ally. Oh, my God, he's 21-1 right now.
That's good. You're back in this thing in a hurry.
You have not attained really long, sort of a far-fetched run here. But if you look at the stats for Michael Yates, I was looking at the really long layoff stats here. First starts, after 300 plus days, he has 29% winners and 43% in the money, with the $2 ROA, $3.42, an average of $12 payouts. So it might not be a super big sample. It's only 7 starters. He had 2 winners there, but it shows to me that he can do it. So I was like, okay, let's see if this horse kind of fits up to do it. Yes, the horse hasn't seen the racetrack in about 336 days. That's what, 21 months? Now, that is long. I know that's long. But if you're looking at his work tab, like his work tab, 36-3 last work over 3 furlongs, 36 flat, you know, that's decent enough. We're not, you know, they're not world beaters here in this field. So I was thinking, to me, that is pretty solid. And I just want to take a bit of a long shot. First time gelding is an angle I also very much like, because it really means that they can move up. Am I taking a bit of a risk here? Yes, always drop now to 19-1 by the looks of it. So I guess someone's agreeing with me here.
Well, and the way that the first two races of this contest have gone, especially, you got to be happy taking a chance like that. JK, what's up?
You threw it to Naomi too fast. I think she was talking about the 7th race.
Oh, yeah, I did. I'm so sorry. I'm talking about the 7th at Gulfstream.
Pete's on the muscle today. He's in a hurry. He must have somewhere to go. Someone's got to tell him these races aren't going to go any faster.
I'm not allowed to go anywhere, JK. Haven't you heard? We're going to bring you – your punishment, JK, is we're going to very quickly give you your – thoughts on race number six at Gulfstream?
Race number six. I liked the eight Mijos, which actually I think the first time we did this show was, yep, I believe it was March 26th, the Mijos ran. I think Matt and I were both on him. He was super wide that day, and that's not exactly where you want to be at Gulfstream. He was going the six that day on the comeback. Now he's going seven, which feels like a more appropriate distance for him. I'm on the eight all day long. I'll take the 3-1 right now if I can have it.
And we'll talk about what the leaderboard looks like in a minute. But Matt, we'll go to you for a thought on this one.
I mean, I went with a little bit of a silly horse in here. I mean, Pletcher's horse can win. Mijos can win. Duchere, I like him a lot. I just don't love him at Gulfstream, the idea of running on that track. I went with the two, Create Again. The most recent start on turf, that field that he ran against was really, really good. You've had four horses come out of that race to earn 90-plus buyers. I know it's on grass and we're running on the main track, but he was facing quality company. It was his first start off the layoff. He showed some big speed and faded. And I know he's done that in the past, but I wonder if just you're going to have the bottom going from a mile and a 16th back to 7/8 here. I don't know that there's a ton of early foot in this race. I think the only chance that he can win, in my opinion, is if they just gun him out of there and try to make the front. I wanted to gamble a little bit. Pletcher can win. Duchere can win. Mijos can win. I didn't love any one of them. I took the two at 18-1.
And Naomi, who did you end up having in this sixth race at Gulfstream?
Oh, I do apologize, guys. But from
not at all. I didn't tee you up very well. That was a host.
I ended up landing everybody a daily double.
Yeah, right.
I've got you guys. I end up on the five non-Cassie here. Interesting. Well, he's dropping in class here. He was trying to close into a slow pace the 1st of December 2019 at Churchill Downs. Now, I know, JK, that is one of your angles. I always listen to you. But it's an interesting angle because I know that it's actually quite tricky for a horse to close into a pace that's really – so, yes, last race, not the best, but facing some very tough foes. There should be a tiny bit easier for him here. I just ended up thinking, yes, this is a tough race. That was one of my notes. This is a tough race. Ended up on the five. My backup was the six, Sniper Shot, Louis Sizer, Todd Pletcher, but really wanted to get some value. So ended up on the five. Do think that Sniper Shot, Louis Sizer, he's just going to gun for it. He's going to try and go straight to the front. Is, of course, the Todd Pletcher runner here. So be the one to beat.
And then we've got that double to your horse in the next potentially to play as well. Let's do a recap of this leaderboard. We've got four people who are in real good shape: Brian Ivory, Ronnie Rouse, Bruce Francisco, and Eric Kurzall. All had the cap horse in the last race. JK, are they home and hosed down for this thing? Or are they going to have to do a little bit more?
I would say home and hosed down to get to make the top 69. Look, I didn't expect that horse to win last time, but they got a pretty big enough lead. It got some sensible horses. If they can pick up just a little bit of pay, pick up a few pieces along the way, they'll be fine.
Sounds about right. And then it's a big scrum in behind. I'm not going to read off everybody who still has the 2620, but I will call out Sean Pillar, Kieran Thornton, and Tom Harrington, and Mark Stillmach and our buddies Pete Cook, Rory Arnold. Oh, no, then we're down into the 2620 crew. So it's just Kieran and Sean who are above the group of 30 that had that first winner. This is going to be interesting. I think we're going to have some real drama play out over the course of these next few races, and we'll see what happens here. JK, what do we think about this favorite?
What do we think about him, Pete? Let's have a look. I mean, why shouldn't we?
Let's dive in.
A look at it, Pete.
I'm kidding. Number six.
Yeah, no, I'm just joking. I was stalling. It was a professional. It was a professional
move.
Trying
to help.
Oh, I appreciate it. Same idea, really. I mean, when you can beat Pletcher, and you can beat Todd. That is Pletcher. And you can beat Chad. You can beat Bob Baffert. You got to try to take a chance. Horses in off a little bit of a break. Can absolutely win, but in this setting, I was going to let him protect me. If you took out XBTV back in February, this horse worked with Blewett, and you'll remember Blewett aired, I believe it was last week. It's all starting to run together if you've been locked in your house like I have. But I think this horse makes sense, absolutely. But off the layoff, And I liked Mijos last time going a distance that he shouldn't be going. And now I think he's going a distance that suits him much more. And so I landed on Mijos, but a sniper shot won. I wouldn't be upset about it. It would help me in the contest. So essentially I have two horses, the 6 and the 8.
Yeah, it is a different dynamic now for those of you in the 2620 club. You probably are happy. If your horse doesn't win, let people chip away with the chalk. Probably not going to be relevant at this point. You just need to find a place or two to strike and potentially have a great position to go on and participate tomorrow and win that seat to the $10,000 Breeders' Cup Betting Challenge. They're starting to load at Gulfstream. So what we'll do, we're going to watch this race, and when we come back, we will talk about a little bit of this racing tomorrow at Oaklawn. JK and I did a podcast. It's up over at InTheMoneyPodcast.com, going over our thoughts on the pick four races at Oaklawn. But we'll get these guys as well. And they are off at Gulfstream. Matt, were you happy with how you broke?
Yeah, I mean, the horse broke fine. I'm curious why we're not going on with it, because I don't think the horse is good enough to sit and win against these types. So it seems like unless they're just burning out there, which is possible. I mean, it's a pretty strong outfield. Yeah, 22 and a piece. They're going. It's not how I would have loved it to go, but at the same time, you know, it is what it is. If you're someone like Jonathan on Mijos, you got to be loving life right now. He looks like he's rolling up into it right quite easily, actually.
Do you agree with that, JK? You feeling this run?
I do, and I'm even gonna show off and say that I won, which I would normally not do in a normal setting because that's the worst luck. It's called mushing yourself, but I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna call him a winner right now.
Well, are you seeing the 7 shorten in your view? Because that would mean that you've won.
Yeah, I mean, the 6 is trying to come back on Mijos. I don't think he's going to be able to, but this is a pretty good effort. Look, he had a really good setup. There's no two ways around that, but this is an impressive effort, and finally, maybe it looks like the horse is starting to live up to, I don't want to say expectations, but we had all thought he was going to be something big late as a 2-year-old and early as a 3-year-old. And
right. I know you do this, Pete. I know you do. And Naomi is especially starting to get as busy as you are with the stuff at Laurel. Whether you're a Timeform US user, a DRF formulator, an Equibase stable alert, when you like a horse that's doing something they probably don't want to do, and then they're coming back finally doing what they're supposed to do, mm-hmm. those are great opportunities to expect that improvement. And that was, I mean, I didn't really even handicap the race. I promise you, when I looked at it, I said, oh, Mijos. Last time short, this time 7. That's who I'm playing. And that was it. It was that simple. Obviously, you got to be a little bit more diligent if you're wagering full, you know, betting hundreds of dollars. But it was that easy for me. I didn't do anything smart. I just, right there in front of me.
Sometimes for a contest, you can be you're an intuitive player anyway, JK, and contests allow you to be a lot more intuitive than when you're betting at the windows and, you know, the structuring your tickets and figuring out what bets you want to make, negotiating those pools. That's an art in and of itself. All right, we've got 5 minutes to this next race at Tampa and a bunch of things I want to accomplish. Before we talk about your all's selections in this race, I do want to look ahead to tomorrow at Oaklawn. Now, Naomi, you tipped your hand a little bit that you haven't done the full job yet on this card, but I am curious, is there any horse in particular you're looking forward to wagering on, or at least seeing who's going to be participating at Oaklawn tomorrow?
Unfortunately for me right now, my form is completely crashing. So I'm just going to do it off the top of my head because I remember going through. I'm very much interested in seeing Horologist coming back here for Richard Baltus. She ran really strong race here against Arafina at Laurel Park. So I remember that she was under continuous pressure and then did not get the bob on the finish line, but it was so close because I remember the owners already celebrating here and then basically running and wondering if they got it. And I was like, oh, I think you lost the bob. And she did. And she's a very tough mare. She was in the care of Lacey Gaudette here before. And she said, God, this is a nice mare. So I'd love for her to do well, but wow, this is such a tough race. I do think that for Serengeti Empress to not do well would mean that someone will go up and sort of put the saw to her and not let her get that easy lead. Safi Joseph has got two horses in here. One of them do like on the top of my head, because still my, for some reason, my computer is just not having a great chat. Oh, hold on. It's starting to start up again now here. He has a cookie dough who I think is quite interesting. I had a look at her last race. She had to come over from that sixth gate and she did so well. I thought she was a little bit keen. I thought she was a little bit sort of, I'm hoping that if there's going to be a strong pace, she might just settle back a little bit better in like perhaps a nice box seat, you know, a couple of lengths off the leader. She might just get a nice toner. Now, like I said, this is such a tough field. I feel like there's five horses that I can start making a case for here. Not just saying Serengeti Empress, not want to diss Tom Amos, of course, on the show, the Fox Sports, doing a phenomenal job. Really think she's the one to beat here. But wow, this is quite something, just going through the field here. I actually quickly caught up with Safi Joseph about his two runners because I was just super interested. And he said, Queen Nakia, the number seven, she is looking phenomenal, like really good coach, just really happy in herself. And she ran behind his other runner, Cookie Dough, last time at Gulfstream Park over mile 16 on that sloppy track. And he said, you know what? She deserves a chance in here. Yes, this is super tough, but she looks great. I like Cookie Dough. Of course, we're in deep here, but we're going to take our chances. So really interested to see how this is going to unfold.
It's a loaded race, and there's a lot of different ways you can go. JK and I had a detailed discussion about it on the show that we posted a little bit earlier today. But Matt, we want to get your thoughts since, you know, now that you're early week only, we don't get to hear you handicap the late week enough. What are some of your thoughts on this Oaklawn late pick four? You know, maybe we'll return to this topic later. Maybe give us some your race that you're the most excited about now, and then we'll quickly look at this Tampa race as well.
Well, I'll be honest with you. I haven't done a deep dive just yet. But if I do go through and look at this Apple Blossom, there's a part of me that looks at it and says, kind of what Naomi was talking about, Serengeti Empress. I can't imagine them just letting her go out there again. And I know she's just naturally very, very fast. I'm not suggesting, and I don't know what the weather looks like tomorrow. Street Band doesn't want to be the one doing the chasing. Street Band doesn't want to be up pushing the pace or relatively close to it the way that she was in that Azari most recently. She's a horse that likes to do her running from well off of it. When I go through and take a quick look, you've got horses stretching out in distance. You've got horses doing a number of different things for the first time. Come Dancing's got to be relatively close. Serengeti Empress is in here. Some of the other horses that we've already heard, they're going to be forwardly placed. There's a part of me that looks at it and says, if she's 15-1 and she can get back to doing what she's wanted to do, and that's rally from off of a hot pace, make that one run, I have to at least consider her. And again, I haven't done the deep dive just yet, but I, at face value, I'm going to be at least intrigued with Street Band and giving her the mulligan on that most recent run.
I think that's very reasonable. All right, we got 1 minute at Tampa. We're going to do a very quick rundown of picks in this race. And JK, we will start with you.
I'm on the 9, Town Classic. The horse is just faster than these. All three of the last races are essentially equal to or better than anything else has run in their form cycle. Outside post, fortified for a reason. I think being drawn outside at Tampa is a very good place to be. The rail is historically not ideal there. I like Town Classic quite a bit here. And if you want $8 in your ADW or 25, go ahead and place it to win. And then take 10% of that and give it to TRF or TAA.
I like it. I'm not on the screen right now where I'd show my chalk-sucking weasel shirt, but chalk-eating weasel, excuse me. But you've got to love where you are in the contest, having had the success you've had to this point, just chipping away with the – you're not disappointed at all to see 4-5 on that horse. Matt, where did you go here?
I went with the 5, Small Fortune. I'm pleasantly surprised about the price. I think it probably level off around 9-2 when it's all said and done. But kind of to Jonathan's point, I mean, the horse is not as fast as far as speed figures are concerned as the outside runner who's 4-5 right now. But I maintain I want to be forward. And maybe this horse doesn't clear off to the front. Maybe sits just off the 3. But either way, I'm going to be content. If the 5 is perched just off that one's flank, so be it. And if for some reason the 3 doesn't go and the 5 can control this thing and try to take him gate to wire for Georgina Baxter, I'll take my chances. A little bit of a jump in class, but I'd rather take my chances there. The horse that this one ran behind by a length most recently, Native Hawk, came back and won next out with a 75 buyer. They were about a football field clear of the rest of the field. So I think the horse fits in here relatively well. And again, 5-1, 9-2. I expect it to be closer to 3-1, so I'm okay with this.
Naomi, what did you do in the contest here?
I ended up agreeing with Matt. I went with a five small fortune. I'm actually made the joke in my head that bit of an older horse, seven, but not the oldest in this race because that's number eight, Divine Ambition, aged 10. But I had a look at his last race at Tempo over six furlong. He was hard ridden to move up from the five post. He ended up joining the leader. They paired, they dueled, they put in decent enough fractions. And then before he tries to clear away and then he gets challenged again. He digs and he just loses. And when you see a horse put in a nice figure of 76, and you know, not groundbreaking figure here in the field, because for example, the Six Door has posted higher figures, but it was a figure that he worked for. And I like to see that. He'd never let up in terms of pressure. And that makes me think that possibly this horse can do better if he just gets himself in a bit of a nicer spot, hopefully, possibly, maybe a bit of a box seat, somewhere just off the speed, not hard dueling for the lead here. I don't think that he should be up on the lead here, but we're going to see. And I thought that might provide me a little bit of value. So I have to agree with Matt.
All right. We'll see what happens. We're getting ready to start loading here for this eighth race at Tampa. The crew has had some success today. Hopefully that's going to continue as we get to see who will advance to this Breeders' Cup Betting Challenge qualifier that will be run over on horseplayers.com. Thanks to everybody watching along live at Facebook Live through the Breeders' Cup page, and everybody listening through the In the Money Players podcast feeds or over at inthemoneypodcast.com. We're happy to have a lot of great material and happy to have a lot of the people who provide it here with us today, including new stuff from Naomi and of course JK. We're gonna let you take off, Naomi, after this race, and we're gonna bring in our final special guest. But you never know on this show. After we had Gary Stevens crash our broadcast last week, but we do have another special guest coming in. And speaking of things on the network, a show that's about to make its triumphant return, which we're very excited about. But Naomi, remind us one more time about your horse. You've got the long shot in the next race at Gulfstream. Before you get out of here, remind us about that one.
Yeah, that was the number three. And unfortunately, I still have a bit of a weird thing going on here with my computer. So number three there at Gulfstream, I'm so sorry. I think my computer just doesn't enjoy me being at the Laurel Park track here.
You have nothing to apologize for. These are tricky times, and we really appreciate you, Naomi, making the extra effort, not just on this broadcast today, but with all the great work you've been doing on the network and down at Laurel. Not easy times for anybody, especially to be so far from home, and nobody is going to question it for a second. And we look forward with great interest that you come up with next week and beyond. Thank you so much for your time today, Naomi Tukker. Long
shot. Thanks so much for having me, guys.
All right, we are halfway in the gate at Tampa Bay, and I'm going to take a break and make sure that Perrin's doing okay over there, and I'll let you, Matt and JK, talk us through this next race.
Where do you want to be positioned early on here with the nine as they break from the gate?
I want to be sitting second or third in the clear on the pace. A little bit further back so far to start. I feel like they're running away from him a little bit, which is a little bit of a concern for me. I'm about to switch my sometimes these horses, they'll kind of pull themselves back into the race. So not ideal starting point.
But I got to be honest, it's got to be an honest pace for them to be strung out the way that they were, 22-1. I mean, they're for this level. These are decent horses, don't get me wrong. But I mean, this is a lively pace here.
Yeah, and he's starting to kind of pick up a little bit. It looks like he's maybe four wide. You know, this idea is going to go away. But if you look at the saddle cloth, you can usually tell if horses are actually on the rail, where the bottom of the saddle cloth met. The four looked like he was off the rail a little bit based on the others. Now, the nine's got a lot of work to do from out here. We'll see what happens.
Everyone's got a lot of work to do. This three keeps finding. Come on, five, go get him. Go get him, five. Go get him. You're a better horse. All right, 5-3. So this is another one of those things for me that going back to what we talked about, I don't know if it was last week or the week before, but with track profiles, it may sound silly, but they're at certain racetracks, six furlongs plays considerably differently than seven furlongs does. And for whatever reason, I have no idea. I'm not smart enough to try to figure it out. All I know is that they do. And if you go through and chart the differences, don't take maiden races because maiden races are very random just in general. Don't take the bottom level claiming races. But if you can get a little bit of a sample size together, you can start to get, you know, Pete, you know, you and I always talk about it. I mean, going back to listening to or reading, you know, Nate Silver's book, you know, you can find some signal in the noise and really can, I don't want to say make your handicapping a heck of a lot easier, but it can. It can essentially, if you look at it and say, on a track where you need to be relatively close, but you've got a horse that's going to come from 15 out of it, I joke with Brittany Ertin about it. Kobe's back, I think, was as talented a sprinter as we've seen in a long, long time. His problem was couldn't get out of the gate, and running at Santa Anita, he had no chance. So for him to run second and third as many times as he did, it was just a credit to him. He was not a good gate horse. But that inherently, I can look at that and say, you know what, at 5-2, I don't need him today because in all likelihood, he's not going to get there.
It's such a major and unappreciated thing, honestly, even among the super talented racehorses. And it's one of the reasons why I think I'm with you, JK, and getting very bullish on Improbable in 2020. Now, rewatching it, he still was a little unruly in the gate the other day, but he broke after all these times of not breaking. And if that can represent a proper forward trajectory, I mean, the sky's the limit for this horse. What do you think about that runner specifically going forward? Are you pro Improbable, Jonathan?
Yeah, I am. I mean, he was impressive. He had impressive races as a 2-year-old. He had impressive races as a 3-year-old. I thought he had an excuse in the Breeders' Cup. And he ran well at Del Mar. He ran well last week. He ran into Tom's the Taw, who is a very talented grade one type of horse. And I think that, you know, if I could, it's weird what the schedule is going to be, but if you gave me right now, and you didn't tell me the date, but if you gave me 4-1 on Improbable to win the Met Mile, I would take it. And I don't know when the Met Mile is going to be.
Yeah, that makes it very tricky. That's for sure. Matt, what do you think about him vis-a-vis a horse who did he get lucky to break the other day because of how unruly he seemed? Or are you willing to now say, hey, maybe he's over that part of his career? I mean, some horses, it's the ultimate sign that they're off form and off form forever when they stop breaking. And you know, Arrogate is at the top of that list for me.
Yeah, no, I mean, I guess the thing with Improbable is this has always been a problem for him. It's not like he's, you know, all of a sudden had issues getting out of the gate. He's been kind of a bad actor from the gate from the very beginning. So to me, it was kind of, this was probably as good as he's looked as far as his antics are concerned, I would argue his entire career. So if you want to say that maybe just that 3-4-year-old transition is all it took, and now he's, you know, mentally got it together a little bit more. And to me, he loses nothing in defeat running behind Tom's d'Etat. Tom's d'Etat has turned into a top flight racehorse. So I have no reason to, he'll never be my favorite, but I have no reason to sit here and try to suggest that. And I can't make up things to try to poke holes in him. I think he's a legitimate horse in these sort of middle distance, mile and a 16th. I don't love him at a mile and an eighth, but I feel like any of those kind of races he fits in.
All right, let's bring in our next guest. We've been talking all about various things going on the In the Money Media Network, and very excited to announce the return coming next week of a show that I never miss an episode, really enjoy the work that he does. Our buddy Spencer, back with us, joining us here today. Spencer Luginbuhl, how are you, my friend?
Good. How you doing, Pete, JK, Matt? How you guys doing?
Life is good. You know, we're doing what we can. We're taking it one day at a time, and we're grinding away. And we're lucky enough once a week to get to do these shows and connect with the audience out there and each other. And very happy to have you with us. What have you been doing, Spencer, in terms of racing? Have you been active, or you been just chilling out?
I've been kind of chilling out recently, just trying to give myself a little bit of a mental break. All the stuff going on with COVID, all the stuff around the country. Just wanted to take a little bit of a back seat with the racing for a little bit. Excited, started to kind of get into it again this week. This is my first contest back. And I just got hot by hitting the 5 in the last race. So we're getting off to a little bit of a late start, but got a couple bombs coming up. So we'll see what happens.
if you've got the right run, it's no big deal. You know, if you're chalk, you're in trouble. But if you've got prices, you can get back into it. Right now, we just had an updated leaderboard, and the cut looks like it's 37. So you can get yourself up in the mix. Tell us about what you have in mind for the next episode of Red Board Rewind, Spencer.
So it's going to be covering tomorrow's action from Oaklawn, and my special guest, he's kind of getting up there with a number of times being on the show, Marshall Sterling. So really looking forward to getting in touch with Marshall and talking about Oaklawn.
Marshall, of course, at G1 Handicapping, known as the degenerate meteorologist, the sicko,
exactly what
it is. Weatherman. It's funny. I've been thinking about him a lot because, you know, I'm Perrin's teacher now, essentially, and they're doing this whole all these units about this whole unit about the weather and all these meteorological concepts and things. And I've almost needed to bring him in as a special guest to help in my homeschooling process. I just have to see now if he speaks Spanish. But we're having fun with that. I'm definitely looking forward. He's done a great job on the show in his previous appearances, and you guys should do well. And speaking of weather, we talked to someone made a reference to Oaklawn tomorrow. It looks like it's going to be clear. So I don't think we're going to be looking at any weather. I mean, we should ask Marshall, but I don't think we're going to be looking at any weather for the day. It seems we should be on a dry track.
I can't afford any rain, so let's keep it dry.
For those who, I'll let you explain that remark, JK. There's a lot of new people watching here. I can see from the numbers. So what are you?
All right. So I've already told my friend Tom Amos, so you don't need to tell him again. All right. I admitted this to him, but after the 2019 Kentucky Oaks, I was driving back with my friend Craig Burnick and to Lexington, and we had enjoyed some beverages, and he hit Serengeti Empress, and I didn't. And it was one of those conversations that you guys have all been a part of. You say, man, she's not even that good. She's never going to win another grade one. And it turned into a wager, a large wager.
A lot of jelly beans.
A lot of jelly beans. And so I've escaped that grade one defeat a couple times because she's run grade one winning races. In the Acorn against Guarana, she ran a grade one winning race. And against Covfefe in the test, she ran a grade one winning race. And if she would have flipped post positions with Covfefe, she might have beat her that day. And so I've been very fortunate to dodge it. And so this is the next test, and I am nervous.
It's going to be fun to see how it plays out. Watch the Fox broadcast tomorrow and look for the perspiration on JK's brow as they're heading into there. Spencer, have you handicapped ahead? Have you done the work on these Oaklawn races yet, or are you going to be doing that tomorrow morning?
It's going to be a tonight, tomorrow morning thing. I'm really looking forward to the Apple Blossom. I'm probably going to end up picking Serengeti Empress again, more or less just to go JK's little bet there. But I'm hoping that, you know, it's not too much pain, just a little bit of pain.
Oh, my goodness.
Come on, Spencer. We're supposed to be on the same team.
You know, I think JK legitimately, there'll be other spots to be more worried. I think it's a tricky spot for her, and I think you've got a lot running for you. Even though I do not like at all the morning line favorite Come Dancing in the race, you've got five or six horses running for you, and it's a tricky situation, as you pointed out, with the short run to the first turn and all that speed in there. So we'll have to see how it turns out. I'll be watching certainly with great interest. I assume, Matt, on your show next week, you'll be looking back at the good stuff from Oaklawn this weekend.
Yeah, checking out the Apple Blossom, obviously checking out the Count Fleet. Is that the 6 furlong race that's going to be going on? So, and it looks like that's a loaded field as well. I don't mean to keep belaboring the Apple Blossom, but in what scenario is Serengeti Empress by herself? Like, unless she's going 45 and change, which I guess, I mean, she's fully capable of doing that, but is she going to have anything left in the tank if she does that sort of thing? I can't imagine her just winging it on the front end and spread eagle in the field. She's capable. I mean, I'm not arguing her talent. I never have. She's always had the ability. It's just, circumstantially, I don't know if I love that at a mile and a 16th with some other, I guess that's the other part too. It's not like it's cheap speed that's around here. There's other talented speed horses that are going to be, I would imagine, within shouting distance. I'm going to lean with Pete and say, you know what, maybe Jonathan, you lose your bet. I don't know if it'll be tomorrow though.
You know, the thing is I think that, you know, you make a good, well, first of all, you cannot belabor a grade one in the middle of a lockdown and a pandemic. You can talk about a grade one as long as you want. You can't belabor. No, I mean, look, I'm scared because she is more talented than I gave her credit for, but I cannot design the race where she's loose going comfortable fractions. And although she went fast last time, she did not have the caliber of horses chasing her, running at her late. Lady Apples beat her before. Cookie Dough, Horologist, Street Band that you mentioned. I love the case you made for her. Point of Honor, who was my choice in the Alabama last year. Come Dancing, who's a grade one winner going 7 furlongs. And so she's going to have real horses running at her. And oh, by the way, the horse that I love in this race on the far outside, Cece.
Yeah, there's a lot of options, but I am glad, JK. I was worried you were going to double down on this opinion. I do appreciate the fact that you've accepted that if you do win this bet, it will be a massive suck.
Just to be clear, I tried to get out. I texted Bernick and said, hey, man, how about we just settle at half? And he said, you pay me? And I was like, oh, no. He's like, oh, no, I'm going to ride it out at this point.
You'd be lucky to get out at half, honestly. you're a gambler. That's how it goes. Spencer, let's talk about you and this contest. You said you got on the board in the last race. That's great. We'll run through the whole leaderboard in a minute. But who do you have here? Is this one of the races where you have a bomb, this seventh race at Gulfstream, happening in theoretically 2 minutes, so probably more like 6 or 7?
I wouldn't say it's a bomb. I did like the outside horse, Ohanzi. I noticed that when you told me to come on at 4, I had the 2 turf sprints. And something that JK's always preached is, you know, have horses on the lead. So Paco for president on the outside. Jane Sibeli does pretty well. The horse is jumping up, first time facing winners. The other horse I had as my backup was the 6 Super Shenanigan. I just like that the Mark Cassie horse is coming with a little bit of a back grass form the first 2 races out. And I just, the 4-1's a little bit short for me. I wish it was a little bit higher, but I'm not gonna, you know, it's not 5-2.
Is it Paco, or is Paco off again today?
Paco's
with the wrist
off. Paco's got a bad thumb.
That would be the problem. There.
Yeah, but I mean, you got Dylan Davis.
Right. Yeah, it's like, if something happens to the president, the vice president comes in, and he usually does very similar things to what the president does. It's not.
Oh my goodness, I'm waiting for an Al Haig, I'm in charge joke. But who did pick up the mount?
Dylan Davis.
Well, Davis, who's been riding pretty well down there. Yeah. I mean, he's had his moments. But, yeah, I mean, Paco for president will be on a T-shirt eventually. We're working on it. JK, we had that good shirt idea the other day for TRF. Do you remember what it was?
Yeah, we got it. We're going to make a shirt. And I think it's – I love the idea. We got to do it. It's a $100 T-shirt, but stay with me. $100 T-shirt, and it says – you win, comma, they win. So when you have a big score, you buy the shirt for $100, $80, $70 goes to the TRF. So you're donating via that way, but you also get to wear this shirt that says that you had a score, you scored out, and then gave back a little bit. So yeah, they win, or you win, they win, or they win. We got to figure out the whole logistics. It's a great expensive T-shirt, but. You know, 70%, 75%, whatever, or all the proceeds, will go to the TRF.
I love that idea. And of course, if you want to just go ahead and go out of your way and give trfinc.org/players, you can give directly to the Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation. Or we also, and this was a great idea JK had, wanting to support some humans directly as well as equines and the TRF during this time to give to the New York chaplaincy because of the great work they're doing. You know, we're under a lot of strain here down in the city, and they are they're really making a difference in people's lives. So we encourage you to do that as well. I love that shirt idea. Let's not forget that. Usually we're pretty good at remembering these things. Let's talk about where you are in this race, JK. What are you got cooking?
Well, there's a handicapping angle here, and there's also a hunch play. I landed on the nine, never stop dreaming, because right now I'm not going to stop dreaming of this summer at Saratoga. I'm going to keep my fingers crossed until someone uncrosses them.
Yeah. I like it. Never stop dreaming. Is there a handicapping angle?
No, there is. This horse had some pretty nice races. Well, barely 2 years old, December 19th. So, 11, 12 days away from being a two-year-old. But had some nice races as a two-year-old. Doesn't have a lot of pedigree to suggest the turf is going to help. But sometimes it's the distance that helps. The flat 5 furlongs are what can really move a horse up. And I don't love the fact, poor guy, but it is. And I am looking forward to the fact of seeing him run after being a first-time gelding. I think sometimes that can help them focus a little bit. And so the ability to run 5 and have a little bit more focus, I think, could turn this one around a little bit. 7-1. I love the fact that I'm protected by the chalk and I have a little bit of a longer price considering my position so far. I think I'm right on the bubble in the contest.
We'll run that down in a minute, but Matt, very quickly, let's get your thought on this. Actually, it doesn't have to be quick. It's Gulfstream. Your thoughts on this first.
Yeah, I went with the 12 Alonzi as well, and I'm cautiously optimistic. I know the horse is 7-2 right now. I'm holding out for 9-2 just based on double wheel pays. I think the horse will float up a little bit. That most recent run, breaking the maiden, it may not look all that strong, but we've spoken about it. It's very difficult to earn fast figures when there's no pace, especially in turf races. And for a 5/8 race down at Gulfstream, for the incremental splits for this horse, 22 flat, 22-2, I mean, that's a walk in the park down there. You very frequently see 43 in a piece for a half mile. So I'm not terribly concerned about the figure that came back for that most recent run. The run 2 starts back is actually the one that makes me think this one fits in here quite well. Couldn't quite get the job done, but the horse that won that day, Camp Randall, came back and won next out with an 84 buyer. There was another next out winner with a 71 buyer. So I went with Alonzi. I don't love the horse by any stretch. I don't love turf sprints at all. But the point is, I think the horse fits in here relatively well and it falls in, again, to the idea for me. I'm not afraid to take horses that won, broke their maiden last out, taking on winners. Maybe this is going to be a mistake for me in a spot like this, but I'm still holding out hope for 4-1, 9-2. I think horse should float up. And as I say that, the horse goes to 3-1.
Well, where you are in the contest, though, not necessarily a big deal, right?
Well, for our contest, no. For the other two, I wouldn't mind a little more.
Give us a little bit of a glimmer into what you're looking at, Matt, in your other contest, so we can root you in there too.
The BCBC qualifier, there's 37 entries. The winner gets in, the second place gets $5,000, and then the next four get $500. I'm in seventh with $50. So I mean, not out of it by a long stretch. For me, it'll probably come down to the ninth race at Gulfstream. We'll talk about that in a bit. And then the 10K game over on Horse Tourneys, I'm 20th. So, you know, I mean, still, I'm only $15 out of the top 7, so, or top 8. So there's still some stuff that can go on here, but go a long way if the 12 could not only win, but if we could get a little bump in price here.
Wouldn't be a bad thing. All right, let's run down the
5-2. What are we doing here?
Well, there's, you know, it's sharp money, I think. Jesus. So the top 16 move on to tomorrow. As of right now, as they're beginning to load at Gulfstream, those top 16 are Brian Ivory, Bruce Francisco, Ronnie Rouse, Eric Kurzall, Ciarán Thornton, Sam Stinson, Michael Warren, William Smith, Matt Bernier, Mark Stillmock, Christopher Olson, Robert Thatcher, David Klein, Chris Couples, James Henry, and then in a scrum at 16th, Todd Van Dree, Jonathan Kitchen, Truls Enge Bretson twice, and Spencer Vandenduhl, all with $37. And then there's a lot in behind. There's all to play for here. We finally have a properly dramatic contest on one of these happy hours. And they're off at Gulfstream.
Wow.
You want to take the lead here, Matt, talking us through?
Yeah, Alonzi is out there on the front end, held at 5-2. I'm a little bit surprised that the horse took as much money as she did. And I don't think they're going guns blazing. I think it's a based on Dylan Davis. I mean, he's like a statue out there. If we saw a 22, I wouldn't be surprised. It's basically 22. You know, we'll see what happens. Super Shenanigan has never passed a horse. So if he does today, it'll be the first time. Look, I couldn't ask for anything more from here. The half mile is going to be close to 44. If she's not good enough, she's not good enough. But this is, I don't know what else you could possibly ask for.
Striding out okay there as they start to turn. I'm looking at the other picture now. This is getting very dramatic deep in the lane here.
Nah, we should.
This is the home. Only dirt course with kickback.
You called it dirt. That was a Freudian slip.
The DERF is firm.
The DERF
but
is firm.
Great pick, Alan Z. Gets it done, if only barely holding off the late charge of Sovereign Warrior at Gulfstream. And that's got to make you feel pretty good, Matt, about punching your ticket and puts you in a decent position. Do your other contests close in the same race as this one, or do they go a little bit farther? How does that work?
Yeah, no, we go right through the nightcap. So there's still two races after our contest wraps up. And I guess it's good news that there weren't a ton of folks that had this filly, but at the same time, and I keep calling her a filly. I hope it's a filly. I'd feel like a dope. It is. No, it's a 4-year-old gelding. It's fine.
You're not hung up on, gender.
Hey. But yeah, it's nice that some other folks didn't have this horse. I'm genuinely surprised and actually went off as the actual, I know it was co-favored, but had more money. And based on doubles, the horse is the fifth choice. So granted, tightly grouped. You know, you had about $8 or $9 that separated the top 4 or 5, but a little bit surprised that the horse went off at 2.5 to 1.
You will see sometimes when you're surprised about how short a horse you like is, I would say a lot of times it ends up being a horse that it does possess speed. Yeah. And one that, you know, I'm going to take a wild guess and say that the computer-oriented players were gravitating towards. Does that sound about right to you, JK?
Oh, absolutely. You know, and I also always, when I see a horse like that, who's the double will pay and the actual win price is different, I want to look at the other parts of the equation, the connections, the trainer, and no funny business, but it can be a betting trainer or a barn that bets or whatever, or an owner that bets or he passes the information along to friends or whatever it might be. So, I always try to look to see when that happens, how it happens, because it's not very often.
If you get into the art of tote reading, which is something that I dabble in from time to time, I think that's a great point. Having an understanding of which connections bet, because you'll certainly see, you know, sometimes we're talking about Nate Silver before and the signal and the noise. Very often there's plenty of signal when you see early betting on a first-time starter, a horse off a long layoff. But then you'll certainly see some barns and especially some owners that always bet. And you'll always see those horses taking money. And then you can know, okay, I don't really have to take this as seriously. There's a lot to it. Spencer, let me ask you, as somebody who, you know, is a student of the game and likes to look at reasons why horses win, how much do you pay attention to how horses are bet? Or do you just try to stick to the form itself?
I think it's super important. Something my dad taught me growing up. My dad strictly plays doubles and exactas. He'll be all over the double will pays trying to figure out, you know, if he has to hedge on a big double or if there's a way, if I can play 3 horses over the 2 horses I have in the double, can I still make out with a little bit of cash? Every single different step you take in doing your handicapping process, there's always, you know, pitfalls around, like if you look too much into why a first-time starter is taking money. But I've always thought that looking at the board is specifically a really important thing to do.
Yeah, for me especially, first-time starters and layoff horses. And all the more important when you're fortunate to play a circuit like New York, where we have an extremely sharp morning line maker. His lines are so good that I really feel like you can take them as an estimation of what should be bet. Mm-hmm. So if they're wrong, to me, that's like very often signal, because they're so objectively correct that when you see the 8-to-1 morning line open at 3-to-1, there's very often a reason. JK, how much tote board reading do you try to do as a player?
I don't really look too much at the win pool. Just because the, you know, it, when the money comes in is a little bit tricky. Obviously, early money hints to some inside information, you know, not inside information, but the fact that, you know, the people know the horse is going to run well, the early money comes in. It's a little bit tricky because a majority of the money that's bet in horse racing comes in the last minute. So you can't really make decisions or design tickets based on that information. So I'll just try to get clues from the will pays, from the double probables, from the exact probables to try to understand where that late money might flash. You know, people, one of the biggest issues I think we have in racing that needs to be resolved, but I don't think it can be resolved fundamentally, which is that the late odds change. And I don't think that we can change that, because by doing that, we would eliminate way too much equity from the computer automated wagers. But what you can do is you can get clues as to where prices are going to go, and you can have an idea. You won't be nearly caught off guard as much as you are if you look at the will pays of the double that's closing in that race. It will tell you essentially where things are going to go. And so that's typically where I'll look, is in those situations to try to read the tote board.
All right. I think we might have a new leaderboard.
I think I'm drawing dead.
Green? You're kidding. Well, let's take a look. Brian Ivory, our overall leader, is 77.80. Bruce Francisco, second, with 70. Ronnie Rath, 67.80. Eric Kurzall, who had that cap horse early, sitting at 64. Michael Warren, 59.20. Styron Thornton, 57.40. Matt Bernier, 56.80. Sam Stinson, also 56.80. Truls Enga Bretson at 47.80. Sean Pillar, 46. William Smith, 46. Mark Stilmach, 43. Nick Kettinger, 43. Chris Olson, 43. Robert Tacker, 43. Men in Black, James Henry, 42.20. But then a big scrum in behind. Why do you say you're drawing dead? Are you blocked?
Well, I have the five who's 7-2. And I'm actually going to pull up and while I'm talking. I should have done this 14 seconds ago. I didn't do it. I'm going to pull it up while we're talking, though. But I think she's going to go off shorter than that, Shippy. She's 7-2 on the morning. I mean, on the board right now. But while I'm looking at that, there's 1, 2, 3, 4 people in front of me that have the five as well. So she's going to have to be a big enough price that I'm going to have to essentially catch whoever is in 12th or 11th place. So I'm going to have to get to 46. So she cannot drop down to where I thought she was going to end up. And I'll tell you right now that according to the doubles, she is going to be, she's $16 in the double, and the 11 is $16.30. So according to this, and this is what I was, this is a perfect time to talk about it, is Shippy is 7-2 on the board. So don't be shocked, because she's going to be the favorite in this race. Most likely she'll be the favorite in this race, or she'll be right there on top of it with the 11. So I'm worried the price isn't going to be large enough.
I was going to think you were still going to get $12 win place out of this thing and be okay. No,
no, she's going to elite. I mean, she'll be.
Yeah. I mean, she 2-1. Yeah.
So 2-1, 8-4 is $12.
Well, it depends. I would say it depends on what Clement's filly on the outside does. I mean, yeah. if she's part of the number, then you're.
So if you don't play a lot of contests, it's not an exact science, but here's what I do. I take the, if you're wanting to know how much something's going to pay, I take the odds, I multiply them by 3, and I add 1. It's not the best science in the world, but it's a good starting point. So if she goes off at 2-1, then I'm thinking I'm going to get $7 or $8 at you know, that's kind of where I'm going to fall. And that's going to be really, really close to making it.
Yeah, I guess that's right. I was thinking it might be a little fatter than that, but it's going to be to be tight. It's going to be tight.
If you have two favorites in a full field, I guess there's a small chance they go off at 5-2, but man, it doesn't feel like it.
No.
And then I think Matt's point is great. Who runs second? Those extra cents you can get when the other favorite runs out can really.
But the other problem with that is, Pete, is if a price runs second, then I got these guys that are behind me and in front of me, and it, you know, it just, it all gets dicey.
Matt, how do you feel about where you are in this mix?
I mean, look, if a bomb were to come in at this point, I guess, you know, there's nothing you can really do about that. But at the same time, this will be one of those days where whether I get into the top 16 or I fall out of it, I'll look at it and say, I'm not sure what else I really could have done here. You know, I was never going to have the cap horse in the first race, or the second race, whichever one it was. And, you know, out of five races, the way that I always kind of just look at it, and Pete, you brought it up in the book, you know, you can see what sort of your $2 mythical win place, so call it $4 a race, whatever that total ends up being for the amount of races there are, I try to just double that to think for a bare minimum of what it would take to be in the ballpark of winning something like this. And I look at it right now and say, in theory, I would have wagered $20 and I have $56.80 back. Not a heck of a lot else I could have done. If I'm unlucky here and you know, the seven horse wins and I, for some reason, get bumped out of this thing, you know, I mean, it is what it is. I tip my cap and say no big deal, but I'm regardless of the outcome today, I'll be pleased because I feel like I've done pretty well. And I feel like I've been, you know, at least if I haven't had the winner, I've been in the ballpark.
When you play what you like and you get in a good position and then, you know, we're always at the mercy of randomness in this game. So I definitely hear what you're saying. JK, I look at this and I think about where we are now. And I do think if we're going to go on with these happy hour contests, which I think we should, we need to attach some sort of significance to being the overall winner, whether that's ITM making a, you know, special donation to one of the charities or whatever it is. I think it would be fun to have a race for first to pay attention to.
Well, we got to do is we got to get with our boys at Old Smoke and we got to come up with this t-shirt and I win, they win t-shirt.
That's not bad. I think we could afford the $100 for that t-shirt. So we'll give them a quick plug because they're doing such great stuff and they've got some fun. I enjoyed their social distancing themed shirt as well that they did in partnership with. See if I can come up with it. Was it with I Am Horse Racing? Was it with Old Friends? Brain not functioning. But
I'm pretty sure I am. I think I am had one. You could also get a CES Inquiry shirt, by the way, which is also another good shirt.
That is the cutest song going. There's no doubt about it. But oldsmokeclothing.com. They've got so much great stuff. And if you use our promo code money over there, you get free shipping. So you can help yourself out heading over there. There's so much good stuff, but I am partial to the chalk eating weasel, but there are many good ones over there. We'll think about that for next week. We'll maybe think about adding a prize for number one overall. And we'll talk to our friends over there about getting our new Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation themed t-shirt working. But, yeah, there's a lot going on, and I mean, JK, how important is it to you, like Matt was saying, when you're at the end of a contest to go back and look at your overall performance and make judgments about it? I mean, do you try to learn every contest you play?
Well, I mean, I think every time you make a wager, you learn, whether it's a contest or not. If you handicap a race and you watch it, you've learned something. You know, for me, I've really kind of try to come to grips with this idea of being less results oriented and being less and being more aware of the luxury of hindsight. You know, I think that a lot of times that if you trust the process and you adjust the process when you gather information that makes it necessary to adjust the process, then you just got to go with it. But I think that horse players that and we all know them, and I love them, but we all know them that say, I'm so mad at myself. I knew I should have used the 7. I told myself I was going to use the 7, but I picked the 6. I'm such an idiot. I knew I should have. But no. Time out. Back up. You picked the 6 for a lot of reasons. There's a lot of reasons why you landed on the 6 and you landed on the 6 instead of the 7. So when the 7 wins, evaluate that, but calm down. Because if the 7 loses, you think you're a genius. So don't allow the results to impact your process. You can always work on the process, but don't allow the results to change what you know is to be the right way to go about it.
it's such a good point, JK. And there's two quotes that bring to mind, and they're seemingly contradictory, but I think that if you think about them both, you can get yourself in the right headspace of what it means to be a successful gambler. And so on one hand, you have the idea, they're both sort of quotes from football, so it's something you'll appreciate, the idea that you're never as good as you think you are when you're winning, and you're never as bad as you think you are when you're losing. But then the other quote, you know, you don't want to dial down too much into that concept, simply because there's also the other quote, and this one we can attribute to Coach Bill Parcells, very involved in horse racing, would be a great interview for you on your new podcast at some point. But the idea is that you are what you are. You can also over-explain and say, well, if the guy hadn't dropped the pass when he was wide open on third down, and if the kicker had made the 42-yard field goal, we'd be 5-0, but really we're 3-2. No, you're 3-2. So it's a very difficult balance to accept reality and not get ahead of yourself, but also not to dive too down into being completely results-oriented. Spencer, you're a buddy who's spent a lot of time, you know, thinking about racing and doing the Red Board Rewind show. I mean, how do you balance these ideas of the seemingly contradictory ideas that it comes to when you're evaluating your own performance?
I think for me, when it comes from evaluating, you just really need to, if you're going to spend X amount of time handicapping, 3 or 4 hours for a card, and you're going to spend 2 hours on your wagers, you should spend the same amount of time going back over the card. I mean, when I'm going over a card, or like when I'm looking at past class races using Formulator, I'm making little notations of how many, like, key races, how many horses came out running first or second. That way I can establish kind of a class par for every single type of maiden race for that month at Belmont or Saratoga. And then going back out of Saratoga, let's say in the Belmont, you kind of know what the strength of each of those Saratoga races are. The more stuff you do after the races, which nobody does, as soon as the race is over, everyone flips the page. You should be spending time at that, like, whether it's after dinner that night. Okay, so I ran third twice. Let me go back to those races. Let me see the winners. Let me see what I could figure out. If I could have gotten to that horse, or if I'm not going to, maybe that's just the type of handicap, right? I'm never going to hit that horse. But then maybe I should avoid playing those races and betting less money on that race.
JK, you sounded like you had something to add.
Yeah, it's, look, when you are this far away from 100,000, then you start to realize that, like, calm down. You just got unlucky. You know what I mean? Like, it's we've all got beat out of big scores by inches. It's a game of inches that can go a lot of different directions based on a whole lot of variables that are completely out of your control and completely unavailable for you to predict. So just trust the process. Go through it. Adjust it more efficiently. Spencer said something that was really intelligent that I bet you a lot of people were probably like, what? When he said you constructed your tickets for 2 hours. So often the biggest mistake that horse players make is that they spend hours, you get up early, you get your coffee, you tell your wife or your husband you're going to go do some work, and you go in the office and you handicap for 3 hours, and then you make your bets in about 8 minutes. It's the other way around. You know the horses, you know the handicapping principles, you see the value quickly. So spend equal time or more time on constructing your tickets and learn to be a more efficient wagerer. If you're making one wager and it's not a win bet, you're wrong. If you're betting exactas on one ticket, you're wrong. Trifectas, one ticket, wrong. Pick fours, one ticket, wrong. Create more tickets and more avenues for you to take advantage of the opinion that you have. And I think that that's a very important part that people misinterpret.
You said before, JK, game of inches. So many of us know that game of inch, when you look at some of these photos, that can be the difference between five-figure scores and getting bupkis. Matt Bernier, when you're hearing us yap about these things and how we evaluate our own play, I know you're very studious about this. You look back at your own plays on the podcast all the time. What have you been able to learn from trying to evaluate your own play that's made you a better horse player?
Well, I don't know that it's necessarily made me better, but I think it at least I accept that there are going to be really, really strong runs, and they're going to be really, really cold streaks. And it just, it's one of those things where, for better or for worse, I know that that's going to be part of the deal. And yes, you know, if you want to say from a public handicapper standpoint, that's not the best thing. Maybe I should be thinking about just taking the favorite. But there's that part of me that looks at it and says that anybody can do that. You know, you got to put a little bit of thought into whatever you're, especially if you're trying to help people learn and sort of teach some different things. Anybody can look there and say, highest last out figure, they're going to win. Well, it's not that simple. So I've got to the comfort level, the sort of comfort in my own skin of knowing that, you know what, when I'm cranking them off, I can go on a torrid pace. I can also be as cold as Antarctica. So you got to accept the good with the bad, but you guys also brought up the process and just, I have as difficult a time as anyone sticking to it, especially during a bad streak where I sit there and I'm like, you got to try something different. Well, maybe you do. And I would strongly encourage people, don't just because it's always worked, don't expect it to always continue to work. You know, I you guys have talked about it, and we know that I'm big into golf. And I mean, you have somebody like Tiger Woods, who after he won the Masters in 97, he immediately tore apart his swing and rebuilt it. And everyone would look at that and say, you just won for fun. Why would you, what's the point? Because he knew he could get better and he could learn from it. And he did that a number of times throughout his career. And I feel like with a handicapping sort of perspective, I've tried new products. I've gone about doing things in a different fashion. But when push comes to shove, you have those sort of staples, those building blocks that you always come back to. And at least I do. And that, those are the things that when I start getting a little bit astray, a little bit off course, say, all right, let's tie it back in. Let's get it, you know, kind of tightened up again. And let's just get back down to the basics. It's the same for me on a golf course. If I start trying to hit ridiculous shots, well, you know, more often than not, they're going to end up in the woods. So let's just get back to the basics and say, rather than try to put it over, you know, carry this thing 290 yards, let's lay up. You know, it may not be the macho thing to do, but I'm going to have a heck of a lot better chance of making par that way than I do trying to put it over the creek. And you know, just, I guess in general, the idea is don't be afraid to adapt, but at the same time, have those building blocks that you can always come back to and rely on.
It's a really interesting idea in racing, though, because it's seemingly contradictory, but I think both ideas are right. On one level, the fundamentals are so important: speed, form, class, pace. And sometimes I think contests can be great for that, because they'll take a player out of the circuit that they play all the time and make them look at something new. And I think that can be like a wonderfully like grounding experience for a horse player to get back into those fundamentals. But at the same time, I'm also very respectful of the idea. And I'll ask you about this, JK, and then I'll throw it to Spencer. But the idea that you always have to be, our game is so tough that if you're not improving, you're falling behind. So how do you, JK, balance those two things of the importance of fundamentals with the idea that you always, you know, like Tiger, need to be on the improve?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a strong believer in a bunch of phrases that I picked up with my stint as a high school football coach here in Texas. And one of them is, if you're not getting better, you're getting worse. And there's no there you don't stay the same. You're either getting better or you're getting worse. And so I love what Matt said about welcome in new handicapping products, new angles, new ideas, new strategies. If you're a guy or a gal that looks at the pick five and you always start with the first leg and handicap that way, tomorrow morning, wake up and handicap the other way around. Who knows? It might not make any difference to you, but just try it. Just try different things that you hear people talk about, because you'll never know what will resonate with you and resonate with your game. And so I'm a huge believer in always trying to improve and to do things differently. I'm trying to think of the most recent thing that I've done. I added Stats Racelens, where I would go to their they have a kind of a predictor of a percentage chance of wins. And then I'll pull up a chart that said that converts a percentage. If a horse is 25% to win, there's a chart that will convert that to what the odds are. And so I would just try to find opportunities in horses that I wasn't going to use that horse, but that horse is kind of an overlay. I should use them, blah, 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 blah. So I think that there's a lot of different things you can always add. And some stuff sticks and some doesn't. But you should always be looking to try to add new things.
Spencer, I want to hit you with that same question. How much are you evolving as a horse player, looking at new things, and how much do you try to dial back to the fundamentals?
I think the number one thing that I've changed in what I do is I start now, instead of starting with race one or the last race, I try and do the I start with maiden races, and then I work my way up the class ladder, as well as starting out on dirt sprints and then going to dirt routes, turf sprints, turf routes. I just think that way, instead of it being like you're going from a maiden race and then jumping up to a stake race, like if I do all the maiden races first, it's kind of the same angles you're always going to be looking for, the same type of, you know, oh, this trainer's really good. Well, he's in three of the four maiden races, so I should probably key off of this guy, especially if his horses are going to be, you know, 6, 8, and 7 to 1, and he has great numbers. Well, this could be a thing where if I can find two maiden races back to back, I'm probably going to add his horse in both legs for the double or the pick three. And then in that certain type of way, you're not going from the dirt to the grass, then back to the dirt. You're just doing everything one by one by one. And it's just a really, for me, easier way to try to simplify it.
All right, we've got 0 minutes at Gulfstream. I did happen to look over at the Facebook live feed. I apologize. There have been a lot of great comments that we haven't been able to get to. But the one cheeky guy who says, do all handicappers have beards, does get props, because that's funny.
Sabrina did say, does anyone own a razor on the live stream? And I was like, that's pretty funny.
Hey, it's a pandemic. We don't have time for
exactly.
I mean, I saw the impeccably groomed Jason Blewett on the feed before, and I thought maybe he's joining the band. So, you know, what are you supposed to do here? Let's talk about this race at Gulfstream, gentlemen. We will start with you, Spencer. What did you come up with here?
So I was hoping to get a better price on the number 8, Mrs. Maisel, but 6 to 1 off a 10 to 1 morning line, I can't really – I guess I should be happy that she's taking some action. I just like the class drop a little bit going from the stake race down to an N1X. It just seemed like the type of move. Also, I think she'll be up on the pace at least, which is like what we like to see with these 5-furlong races. The other horse that ended up being my backup was the 11, Notorious RBG. Christoph Clement is definitely one of my top turf trainers. And just if she can improve second time out, definitely going to be one there at the end.
Are you going dead in the contest, I assume, Spencer? Are you too far back?
I'm 41st with eight people blocking me. So we'll just see what's happened at this point.
Even get a winner in to end things.
Yeah.
Matt Bernier, where are you? And I assume you're feeling pretty good about your chances. Tied for 7th moment.
Yeah, tied for 7th. I mean, again, if a crazy bomb comes in, it is what it is. I'll just tip my cap and say we'll move on. I really think the Notorious RBG is a talented filly. I think for Clement, to have her ready to go first out of the box, breaking from the rail, and be able to win the way that she did. I know it was a 3 or 4 horse blanket. I just thought it was a really encouraging debut. I respect her here. She can easily win. I just thought the price would be a little bit short. Look, I do love Midge Maisel, but at the same time, I don't really need her here this afternoon. If she wins, she's a great price, right? I mean, five, well, I shouldn't say great. I expect her to be a little bit higher than 5, but she definitely has a puncher's chance coming out of that stakes race. I ended up with the 3 horse. Another angle that maybe percentage-wise is not the highest as far as strike rate is concerned. I'm not afraid of playing horses going from Tampa to Gulfstream. And this number 3 horse here, Poseidon's Passion, I love that the horse has won on the lead and most recently won from just off of it. It was close to hot fractions at Tampa. Tampa is just as bad, if not worse, than Gulfstream about 5-furlong turf sprints, where if you're not on the engine, you are in deep, deep water. For this horse to be able to overcome that, I thought that was a promising enough effort. I liked a Tampa shipper yesterday who ran quite well, couldn't get the job done, but finished 3rd. 8 to 1, I think, is more than fair. That's what I was looking for. So for me, it's Poseidon's Passion here.
RBG looking very nice. The 11 looking very nice on the track. Not a big thing, but nicely muscled, warming up well, ears alert. Looks very. Jake.
Well, first of all, I got a message from the man in black that he's enjoying the show, so I had to give him a shout out because I wore this for you. I wore this for you. The second thing is that he wouldn't shake your hand before all this. There's no shot in shaking your hand. Yeah,
that's it. We may never see him in person again.
So here's what I'll say.
And if we do, the man in black will turn into Darth Vader with the full regalia, respirator and all.
The thing, Mrs. Maisel, I'm telling you right now, she is bet as short as she is because of the quarantine. Everyone's watching that show and they're betting her. I'm dead serious. If you look at the doubles, she's like the sixth choice in the doubles. And she should be shorter. The two should be much shorter than her. They're betting her because of that. I love the 5 and the 11. I feel like one of them has to win. And I'm playing doubles in real life, a little bonus coverage. 5-11 with the 6 and the 9th, Fortin Hill, who is a Chad Brown horse that's been working with Instagram, who obviously has been moved to Chad Brown, has been working right there with him. And I think that that's an easy, easy single in the next. So I'm going to go 5-11 with the 6 and the double.
Is Instagram still Larry Best, or has the ownership?
I'm sure it's the same ownership. But Larry, you know, obviously Larry had horses with Chad already, and I'm assuming that for whatever reason he's moved Instagram to Chad.
Still one of the weirdest stories that we've seen in our time in racing, what happened with Instagram as a 2-year-old. Probably one of those where something happened that we won't ever hear about. But
you know what, though? You know what, Pete? And this is nothing more. This is pure conjecture, pure speculation. I wonder if all along they knew the horse couldn't go that far. And it was a bit of a cop-out saying, like, oh, you know, we want to save him. We want to know. You knew that he wasn't going to be able to get a route of ground. That's an easy way out.
That's a very good
point.
Just
my conspiracy theory mind going right now. That's it.
I'd much prefer those conspiracy theories, Matt, to some of the ones going around right now. Loading at last race of the contest here. JK, what do you think? You're not. We think you're drawing dead. We think Matt is drawing very live. Yes.
Yeah. No. I think I'm dead. Not only am I a bad price, but I think the 11 is going to be extremely tough too. So I'm really up against it.
You could make the argument that 2.5-1 on Clement's Filly is a good number.
Look good out there. Yeah. Just look quick. We'll see what happens. But I'm not. I don't have time to get a bet in. But I'd bet the 11.
I thought she was really impressive in that maiden score. Like I said, not only was it 5-8, but down on the rail, that's not an easy position to be breaking from. Three horses have come out of that race, and they've earned low to mid-70 buyers. I think there's a lot to like there. They break from the gate. She's a little bit slow in the stride.
I'll let you guys talk us through this one.
You got the 3 and the 9 out there on the front end. My horse, Poseidon's Passion. I didn't anticipate being dueling on the front end, but hopefully this 35-1 shot leaves me alone. Shippy is in a really nice position. So I'm curious. I didn't like Shippy, but the horse is even money. And Jonathan, I know you are quite fond of her.
The 11's in a gallop.
The 11 looks
Kathy Ritvo to George Weaver is like the biggest trainer trainer ever.
No, look, I'm not disputing that. I didn't see the 2-year-old form that made me, by the way, kick away 3. Poseidon's Passion. Change leads and go.
Here comes the 11.
Change leads 3. Change leads 3. Might not even need to change leads. It's still Poseidon's Passion, the leader. Envied is on track. Time ticking away. We're home and hosed. Shippy, who's loose and charging.
Coming home for the wire. Shippy's first. Oh, Shippy. Come on, Shippy.
I think the 3 held on.
I tell you what, that red thing is annoying. I can never figure out if I hit it or not.
I think the 3 held on.
The 3 held on.
By the way, this would be a crushing defeat. This would be a crushing defeat if she does not hang on, because I had win money, contest all over the place.
I bet a double with I would normally defer to your real bet, but I need Shippy for real money too, so I can't give it to you. We're gonna have to fight this one out for the end.
Yeah, we're clear.
Oh, I think you're not clear. I got the bomb.
I think the 5 got the bob. I think the three's all right.
Dead tight. Dead tight. Spencer, what did you think?
I think it's the 5.
Oh, God, it might be.
I got a bob. I mean, that red thing is ridiculous, by the way.
JK got the bob today. Now Serengeti Empress is going to get the bob tomorrow. So I don't know.
I'll tell you what, the cameraman down there thinks it's.
Yeah, these cameramen. Hey, here's what I'll say. Let's just take like the ear off of that dragon out there. Let's sell it. Let's take the money and let's get like a proper. Oh, darn it!
Wow.
The dragon or the Pegasus? Which one do you want to take the ear off of?
The dragon. We don't want to mess with the Pegasus.
Let's see this. So there's your bob right there. I don't even think the 5 ever got. The 5 never got by.
I'm not sure that even makes sense to me.
The 5 never even. No. No, the 5 got the bob, but never got that.
Stop it.
So you have this 3 contest too, Matt?
Yeah, I've got this three everywhere, cash and all the contests. I'm going to steal a line from my buddy Mike Joyce. You could drive a bus through that.
Oh, I'm kidding.
Yeah. I'm teasing.
You're looking at the shutter cam. You're at the shutter cam. You're trying to look around the pole like this.
Captain, here. Hopefully, you're going to win everything today. What are the other contests you're in? Remind us.
BCBC, but I think there were some other folks that had this horse. And yeah. Then the 10K over on Horse Tourneys. Yeah, I'm not lying. I mean, look, that was much closer than I thought it was.
Dead tight. Dead tight.
Just there's tight. Two. Actually, look, Ed Peters in the BCBC contest, he was only 60 cents out of first, and he had this horse on top. So he's sitting pretty right now. I think I might move up to like third. So I'm not, I mean, I'm drawing live. I also have probably the longest shot on the board in the next race.
How did you get there in the contest, Matt?
To where I'm at now.
How many places get the prize?
Oh, so just the winner gets the BCBC seat. The runner up gets the 5,000 piece, and then the next four get 500 back, which again, I qualified for a 10th of that earlier. So yeah. There's that. And actually there should be a leaderboard. Hopefully.
Ed Peters, a great player. Some would say he probably should have won the Del Mar Breeders' Cup, JK.
I'm not touching that one.
You're not going there?
I don't want to get anybody upset from their basement.
Yeah, so Ed Peters is now I'm not yeah, we're gonna gloss over that. Ed Peters is at $128. He is now $21 clear of Peter Bear, who's in second at 107, and I'm third at 95.40. So I'm right in the ballpark with that. And then as far as the cash tournament goes, I'm in third there as well. So, and Ed Peters has the first and second entries in the cash contest.
In all seriousness, a great player and a very nice
cleaning up.
Antini on the Derby Trail old message boards. I met him at the Breeders' Cup. He's a great, great guy. Really, really like Ed Peters. But obviously, Matt, we're pulling for you. It'd be great.
This is another one of those things though, where I've been so. It's been a combination of me being terrible and also just being out of the loop. I don't know who half these people are anymore. Where I felt like for a minute, like I was starting, there was going to be some camaraderie. I don't know who anyone is, and I don't mean that in a bad way. It's been a combination of me being terrible and just not being locked into contest world to, I don't know who three quarters of these people are.
All right. We're going to button this thing up before I read the final leaderboard, which just came through. Spencer, I want to throw it back to you one more time. When do you anticipate the newest episode of Red Board Rewind posting on the In the Money Network?
Me and Marshall are going to try and get it done sometime Sunday. So hopefully Sunday night, maybe Monday morning. Depending on how much of the editing I have to go through and do.
We know how that works. We appreciate you being back in the fold very much. It's good to see your bearded face, Spencer. And we will be talking very soon. Cheers, my friend.
Absolutely. All see right. You guys later.
Cheers, buddy. Let's run through this leaderboard. We have in first place with 9380, Michael Warren, followed rounding out the exacta, Matt Bernier, 9140. And then I'll just run down the rest. Sean Pilar, Brian Avery, James Man in Black, Henry, John Gasper, Stephen Dudenoth, Bruce Francisco, Ronnie Rouse, Charles Myers, Eric Kurzall, Dylan Donnelly, who I'm mad at myself because I meant to bring Dylan on to the broadcast this week. We'll bring him in next week. Sam Stinson in 13th, Nancy Spence 14th, Bill Mentis, good to see his name up there in 15th, and Ciaran Thornton holds on for 16th. And hey, here's a good story. Normally, you'd be like, oh, the bubble is Sam Stinson, 5680, but his other entry made it. So, you know, you can't feel too bad. So those are the 16 qualifiers. You can play along with them tomorrow. On
hey, I'm almost done, okay, bud?
What you got, Jake?
Oh, no.
Oh, Austin. How are you, Austin? Let me bring Perrin over to say hi to you.
Austin just goes, what the heck is that hat?
He's not wrong. We had a few tough beat stories here as well. There always are, but we're looking at it just raw in terms of dollars. We had Peter Rotundo Sr. just missing out, and Naomi with a furious lead. too, but those are the 16 who made it on. Matt, any closing thoughts from you before we get out of here today?
Yeah, look, good day of racing. Knock on wood, the rain holds off. I know that was a bit of a threat down there in South Florida for these last two races, but look, this has really become, and I'm not just saying it for the three of us, but I feel like for other people too, there are enough people that have been following on Facebook. Apparently, we're going to be going on Twitter next week as well. It's become something that I look forward to every week, just to be able to kind of shoot the breeze for a little bit, whether we do well or we don't do well. We can chop up different things, and it's, again, trying to maintain some normalcy in a very non-normal sort of time. So I've grown to appreciate these Fridays more than can be expressed. So it's been a good time, and hopefully I can pull something out here in these last two races.
Thank you, Matt. We'll be rooting for you. Give us the update on the show on Monday. Let us know how it went. Hopefully you're going to come back reporting that you won a $10,000 Breeders' Cup Betting Challenge. See, you have finished in the top 10 in that contest before and are sure to do so again. And JK, you've underperformed in that event, but we've got to get you into the we're gonna get you up there in the money at some point with your skills. Anyway, it's time to wrap. It's you know, my duty as a house husband. I gotta get dinner on the table or I'm gonna be in all kinds of trouble. So we're gonna wrap this up.
And
yes, sir.
Real quick, I text George Weaver and I said disgusting nose, and he said Louis Saez jumped off and said I was tons the best and I let myself get beat.
Ooh. Hey, you know what the good, you know what the good news is? You know what the good news is?
I'm just telling you.
It doesn't make a difference to me because the money is in my bank.
No, it's perfect.
The Bill Parcells quote once again, JK.
It's perfect. No, I was just saying, I wasn't talking about the pick. I was saying,
I know.
Put a note in. When she comes back, you know you're going to get a better performance out of her. Matt Bernier and everyone else who used the three, they got the money today and they deserve it.
What did he, what, in your view, I was going to the washroom. Was there a tactical error in the rut?
I didn't see it. I was watching the 11 the entire time because she started kind of retreating early. So I'm
watching the replay now, and I know we got to bail out of this thing. He's between horses right now, probably three off of it. I have to be honest, I was stunned when I saw Herbie, the one that sort of lunged at the end, because I thought the other horse was making the move. Now she's down about 2-3 path.
Oh, right there.
Yeah, got in a little bit tight in between horses. And then right whenever there,
I hate in between. I hate in between.
Yeah, and then when she finally got to some breathing room, she kicked on in a big way. Now, the other thing, too, is this is her first time on grass, right?
It is.
So, you know.
She's a midshipman, though. She's a midshipman, so yeah. she's meant to run well here.
So, I mean, that's definitely, like you say, throw that in a stable mail or horse watch or whatever you got.
One for the horse to watch list. Okay, let's do the thank yous. We're going to start with JK, Matt Bernier, Naomi Tukker, Spencer Luginbuhl, Peter Rotundo at the Breeders' Cup, and everybody at the Breeders' Cup. Producer Craig, a.k.a. DJ Unstable, for all of his efforts. Everybody who took their time out of their day to watch us and comment on the Facebook feed. I feel bad. It's hard. Keeping the ball in the air, it's hard to deal with all the comments. I know there were some great ones. I feel bad I didn't get to hardly any of them. But thank you all for participating. We really do appreciate it. Everybody listening out there, especially in the In the Money universe, we really appreciate it. You've really kept things rocking and rolling on this network, and we do appreciate it. This show's been a production of In the Money Media. Our business manager is Drew Cody. Our chief creative officer, Jonathan Kinchin. I'm Peter Thomas Fornital. May you win all your photos.